Chapter 6 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Lena Emsley. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 6. John Faunce's Experiences, Number 29. I began life with a very small stock in trade in the way of education. My father was a clerk in the insurance office in a town in the north of England, and I was sent at an early age to a cheap school at Calais, where I stayed 5 years, during which time I learnt the French language, the coup de savate, and very little besides. My father died while I was at school, and my mother married a stationer and bookseller in the town where she had lived in all the years of her first marriage. I soon found that there was no home for me with my stepfather, unless I were willing to be a common drudge in his business, and to stand being bullied at that. So as soon as I was tall enough, I entered the force as a raw lad, keen to pick up every scrap of knowledge that came in my way. I was a diligent reader of the daily papers, and there's a good deal of education to be got out of a respectable newspaper. I was a devourer of novels, and the time that other men gave to outdoor amusements, I enjoyed sitting in a quiet corner with my nose in a book. Good novels were dear in my young days. I couldn't get David Copperfield or Vanity Fair for sixpence, or Ivanhoe for threepence, as people can now. But if I couldn't buy, I could borrow, and books were my only extravagance. I was not a dab at cricket or football or any athletic sports, and so, somehow, my education advanced a good deal faster than that of the fine, manly fellows who spent all their holidays batting or bowling on scorched grass, or rustling and kicking one another on a muddy field. In my early days I used to fasten on to any novel that was offered me, good or bad. But as I advanced in life and picked up more knowledge, my taste improved, and of late years I have restricted my reading to the works of four masters in the art of fiction, Balzac, Dumas, Scott, and Dickens. The first I read for education. Balzac was a born detective. The second and third served to quicken my mental circulation when the dullness of the daily papers begins to exercise its deadening influence. The fourth I read for enjoyment. Pure and simple. The fairy land of Charles Dickens is a paradise whose golden gate I open only when I feel myself brain weary and heart sick, nauseated by the hideousness of real life. It is only natural, perhaps, that a man of my calling should take a keener interest in stories of crime than in any other form of fiction, and I am not ashamed to confess a liking for those novels in which some mystery of guilt is woven and unravelled by the romancer. I have read, I believe, all the criminal stories of Gaboriau and Boisgobey. I have hung spellbound over Bulwer's Lucretia, over Armadale and the Woman in White, over Martin Chuzzlewit, Bleak House, and the unsolved problem of Edwin Drood. And inspired by this recreative reading, I have been beguiled into writing a detailed account of all those cases in which I have been engaged, and that have offered any kind of interest to the novel reader. But alas, when I compare the facts of any case, however mysterious, with the complications, coincidences, passions and counter-passions of love, jealousy, hatred and revenge, which the novelist can elaborate, sitting at ease in his armchair, I can but feel the limitations of a writer who recounts actual experiences, and those often of a most sordid kind. So much for my brief preface, written perhaps rather to excuse myself to myself than as an apology to future readers who are not likely to see these lubrications of mine till I am beyond the reach of criticism. And now for my narrative. The 29th in my book of selected experiences, and possibly the last of such records, as I have serious thoughts of retiring from the criminal investigation force. I have dined well. My wife has gone to see the pantomime at Drury Lane with a neighbour. My fire burns cheerily, the house is quiet, and I feel the impulse to authorship strongly upon me. If nature had but gifted me with invention, I am in the humour to begin a modern Monte Cristo, or to delve into the dark morass of Louis Philippe's Paris, to pluck out some black pearl of criminals like Balzac's Ferragus. But alas, I can only write of that which I have known and seen. Hard matter of fact is the stuff with which I have to deal. The Bloomsbury murder offers a more than common interest to the student of crime. Firstly, because it is more audacious in execution than the average murder. And secondly, because however close a web I may be able to weave about the murderer, there may at the last remain an element of uncertainty that will prevent a conviction. The daring openness with which the murder was committed is new in the history of deliberate crime. A man follows a woman upstairs to her room, shoots her through the head, and goes quietly and quickly downstairs again, and is out of the house before anyone can stop him. A cool hand, this, especially when it is remembered that though the hour was late, the streets were not empty, and his manner and aspect as he walked away from the scene of his crime could have shown nothing to attract attention, since the closest inquiries failed in discovering anyone who had noticed a foot passenger of hurried or agitated appearance, or in finding a cabman who had taken up a fare between 1 o'clock and 1:30 in Dynevor Street or in the immediate neighbourhood. But although I failed in the endeavour to find any trace of the murderer after the murder, I was so fortunate as to obtain a very distinct trace of him before the crime was committed. My cautious inquiries among the servants belonging to the adjacent houses, mostly lodging houses, and the servants mostly of the genus denominated girl, resulted in the discovery of a maid of all work at number 16. 3 doors from the scene of the murder, who had been waiting at the area gate between 12 and 1 o'clock, on the watch for a poulterer's boy with a Christmas turkey, promised early in the evening, but not delivered till after midnight, owing to the pressure of business on Christmas Eve. This girl, who is intelligent, and I think truthful, related her impressions about a tall, broad-shouldered man in a top coat and a bowler hat, who had walked past the area gate several times in conversation with Lisa Rayner. The girl knew all the lodgers at number 13 by sight, and she could swear to the woman walking with the tall man as the third floor back. She had often noticed the third floor going home late of an evening, and had thought it odd that a prudent young woman should care to walk alone after dark. She had met Mrs. Rayner sometimes in the further squares, Gordon or Tavistock, when she, Phoebe Miller, had been returning from her evening out, and she felt sorry for her, seeing her always alone. Once, on coming home from an evening with an aunt at Walworth, Phoebe had seen the third floor lodger sitting on one of the stone seats on Waterloo Bridge, the most desolate figure as ever was. In the course of such inquiries we have to listen to a good deal of irrelevant matter, to swallow a good deal of chaff with our grain. But I did not consider anything I could hear about the murdered woman's habits irrelevant, or without a certain value. Phoebe Miller had been all the more interested in the gentleman walking with Mrs. Rayner because it was the first time she had ever seen her in company, and for a further reason, that while Mrs. Rayner was crying quietly behind her veil part of the time, and at one time sobbing violently, the gentleman also appeared agitated. She had heard him say, "For God's sake," more than once in his talk as he passed her, and once, "For God's sake, my dear love," which made her think that he must be an old sweetheart of Mrs. Rayner's. Questioned as to the number of times the two had passed her, she began to waver, as this class of witness always does. She would not pledge herself to any number between 3 and 15. She was sure they had gone by more than 3 times. She was sure they had not passed her as many as 15 times. They walked as far as the first crossing each way, and then came back. I paced the distance when I left her, and found that, taking it at a woman's average pace, the walk each way would occupy 5 minutes. Say that they passed the girl 6 times, there was half an hour disposed of, and they were hardly likely to have walked in that one spot for half an hour. No doubt the girl unconsciously exaggerated the number of times she had seen them go by. Questioned closely as to the scraps of conversation she had caught as they passed her, she could remember only 3 or 4 broken sentences. Once Mrs. Rayner had said, "I believed you would keep your promise." Once the tall man had said, "When we were so miserable together." She had also heard the word "gold mine," and also the word "Africa." This appeared conclusive. The man who gave her the African notes was the man who murdered her. Asked if she would be able to identify this man if he were brought before her, Phoebe gave me a positive affirmative. Yet, on my questioning her closely as to his features, she could tell me nothing except that he was dark and that he had a light brown beard. Was it a long beard? Not like the man's who sells turkey rhubarb in the Euston Road on Saturday nights. What kind of beard was it? Short and square-like, and a very pretty colour, reddish and goldish, but more gold than red. The man was dark, with a light beard. So far, so good. Of his features she could say nothing. Nose might have been an aquiline or snub. Eyes might have been black or grey. All but the beard was a blank, save the dark complexion, which might have been the shadow of the bowler brim. To judge of a complexion in the doubtful light of London gas on a December night would be no easy matter. Phoebe protested, however, that she would know the gentleman again anywhere. Experience has taught me what to expect from a witness of this class for the purpose of identification. Had she seen Mrs. Rayner and the gentleman go into number 13? No. She had lost sight of them when the boy came with the turkey. She had taken it from him at the gate, informing him that he deserved an hiding for being so late, and she carried it down to the kitchen and shut up the house for the night. Being asked if she could name the time when this happened, she replied glibly that it was 1:45 by the kitchen clock. But she confessed that the kitchen clock was generally slow and never to be depended upon, which had caused complaints from the lodgers upon the subject of unpunctual meals. Poor Phoebe. She is a pleasant-spoken girl, full of intelligence, but I foresee in her the worst kind of witness, loquacious and much too eager. The notes on the Johannesburg bank, and the mention of Africa, overheard by Phoebe Miller, sufficiently indicated the point upon which my first efforts ought to be concentrated. I had to find the man from Africa. All the probabilities of the case, as at present shown, pointed to him as the murderer. He had been with her a very short time before the shot was fired. The unreliability of the clock in Phoebe's kitchen made precision as to minutes impossible. But a girl living within hearing of more than one church clock would hardly be far out in her idea of time. He had been engaged in a painful conversation with the victim, as her tears demonstrated. There had been words spoken that indicated the breaking of a promise. They were on such terms that the woman would not have been afraid of admitting him into the house, while the evidence as to her character, from her landlady and her fellow lodger, would show that she was not the kind of person to admit a stranger. There remains, for after consideration, the possibility that a stranger may have got into the house without her knowledge, someone who knew of the money upon her person and who meant to rob her. But that anybody entering the house for that purpose should have acted as the murderer acted seemed to the last degree unlikely. No alarm was given till the shot had been fired. There was nothing to arrest the criminal and his design. The manner of the murder and of the man's departure go to prove that he had but one motive for entering the house, and that was to put Lisa Rayner out of this world. For some reason or other, here was a woman to be suppressed, and this man took the shortest and boldest way of suppressing her. Was it the man from Africa? The sum of money which I have no doubt had just passed from his hands to hers a few hours before her death point to a blackmailer. The fact of her abject poverty during her residence in Dynevor Street is no argument against this supposition, since she told Mrs. Delamere that she had lost sight of the man she loved and knew not whether he was dead or living. The man she loved reappeared on the scene and sought her out immediately on his arrival. The recent date endorsed upon the notes would show that he received them shortly before he left Africa, since it leaves an interval only long enough for the railway journey from Johannesburg to Cape Town and the voyage to England. He communicated with her, therefore, immediately upon landing, and he gave her this, for her, large sum of money. Yet her conduct while carrying those notes in her bosom was the conduct of a woman in deep distress. His bounty, therefore, had not satisfied her. There was trouble between them, a promise unfulfilled. Was that trouble sufficient to make him a murderer? Was it so essential to him to get rid of this woman that he did not stop short of a heinous crime in order to free himself? The answer to that question depends entirely on the character of the man. There is nothing in which one man differs more from another than in his respect for human life. There are born murderers as well as born poets. Indeed, I incline to believe that the murderer is born, not made. He is not the victim of circumstances, the creature of environment that we are disposed to think of him. He comes into this world with ferocious instincts to which bloodshed is almost a necessity, or with a pitiless hardness of heart and mind to which the cold, carefully calculated murder is as easy as a problem to a born geometrician. The murders that have been committed on trivial grounds, for a very small gain, or to escape from a not unconquerable difficulty, go to prove that there are minds which resort to crime at the first temptation, or at the first necessity. The man from Africa I take to belong to this class. The woman had given him the strongest indications that she meant to be troublesome. He had promised her something, most likely marriage, and she meant to make that promise a whip of scorpions for his back. A dull, heavy man, perhaps brutal, callous, not able to look beyond the narrow circle of his own immediate interests, and thus seeing only one escape from his difficulty. Here was a life that was likely to be a trouble to him as long as he lived. The only remedy was to cut that life short at once, before the story the woman had to tell had been told where it could most injure him. A weeping, loquacious drab, ready to whimper her tale of wrongs into every ear. He had been living a wild, adventurous life, perhaps, on the dark continent. Had lived with a revolver in his pocket, ready to exchange shot for shot, to slay rather than be slain. He had seen sudden death very often in that wild land, no doubt, and the shock of it would hardly touch his hardened nerves. He had his revolver in his pocket while the woman was walking at his side, crying and complaining, upbraiding him for his desertion in the past, urging him to make all good in the future. And while she was sobbing out her reproaches, he was considering how the thing might best be done. The man from Africa was obviously the first person to be found, and while I breakfasted at a coffee-house near Dover Street, I looked up the papers for the arrival of steamers from the Cape. I found a Saxon had arrived in Southampton early on the previous day. On a business day, I should have gone straight to the London office of the company to begin my inquiries, and also to the office of the South African Banking Company in Threadneedle Street. But, the day being what it was, I felt that my only chance of doing business was in Southampton, so I made my way to that port by the first train that would take me, which was a slow train and crowded with holiday people. At Southampton, my business was to get on board the Saxon, or better still, find the head steward on shore. He was almost certain to be spending his Christmas day on terra firma, and it would be lucky for me if I found him without much trouble or delay. The office of the African Steamship Company was closed, so there was nothing to be done there. The ship was lying in the Solent, and if I could get no information on land, I should be obliged to have myself put on board her. The day had turned out badly. A thin, fine rain was falling from a low grey sky. The docks and their neighbourhood were wrapped in gloom. The water was hidden under a grey fog. There was no use in my going on board the deserted steamer till I had tried to find the head steward in Southampton, where he was more likely to be spending Christmas Day. If he was an old servant of the company, he was probably to be heard of at some tavern near the docks. The process of inquiry need not be recorded. It was more tedious than usual on account of the day. It was everybody's dinner time, or after dinner time, about the docks. The air was heavy with roast beef and plum pudding. Turkey and sausages mingled with the odour of strong drinks in bars and bar parlours. It was night before I discovered the steward's whereabouts in a villa on the road to Bassett, and it was supper time when I presented myself in the steward's snug little dining room, where he sat in the bosom of his family, embowered in holly, and cooking himself in the heat of a gas chandelier and a roaring fire in honour of the season. The head steward is a man of the world, and accustomed to be intruded on at all hours. He received me very civilly, though the wife and family looked somewhat ruffled at my intrusion. When I had explained myself and the cause of my visit, he insisted on my sitting down to supper which meal was not unwelcome, as I had been sustaining life on sandwiches and whisky and soda since I left London. After supper, he withdrew with me to the opposite parlour, otherwise drawing room, where there was more gas and more fire, and where we sat at a circular table covered with devotional books and photograph albums, and where Mr. Palby, head steward on the Saxon, answered as many questions as I liked to put to him. Now, in his capacity as head steward, it will be remembered that Mr. Palby would not be likely to know anything about second-class or steerage passengers. And what grounds had I for supposing that the man I wanted would be a first-class passenger, making the voyage under the eye of the head steward? My reason was that the man who gave £120 off-hand to a woman he had wronged was a man who must have been flush of money, and would be, therefore, likely to secure himself as much comfort on a winter passage as money could buy. These are the facts I was able to elicit from Mr. Palby in a conversation which lasted from 10 o'clock till midnight. His family were playing snapdragon in the dining parlour when we began our talk, and they had all gone upstairs to bed nearly an hour before he let me out into the chill, misty night. However prosily the steward rambled in his talk, it was not for me to cut him short. Patience and perseverance, a ready perception, and a quick hearing are the main requisites in my calling. But indeed, without egotism or self-praise, I may add that to do well in the criminal investigation force, a man must have all his faculties in good order, and must have the power of sustained attention in an high degree. A man who yawns in the middle of a prosy conversation is not the man to squeeze the gold of fact out of the quartz of twaddle. There were not many first-class passengers on the Saxon on his last trip. Adult male passengers, only 6. One of these was a consumptive patient who had been sent to the Transvaal to be cured, and who was coming home to die. This poor gentleman hardly left his cabin during the voyage, and was carried ashore at Southampton. Another passenger was an old man, an Africana merchant travelling with daughter and grandchildren. 3 others were men with wives and families. The 6th was a bachelor. Tall, broad-shouldered, good-looking, with a sunburnt complexion and a light brown beard. Here was Phoebe Miller's description. The dark complexion, the fair beard. The steward knew very little more about this gentleman other than his name. Wildover. Alfred Wildover. A.W. The initials worked on the old silk neckerchief which the murdered woman had been wearing. A young lady who was travelling alone was on very friendly terms with Mr. Wildover, and seemed to be an old acquaintance. Asked if there was anything wrong between this young lady and gentleman, the steward assured me that the young lady's conduct was perfectly correct. She had high spirits and was a bit wild, romping with the children on deck, and Mr. Wildover was often among them, and some sour old ladies on board had talked about it. One of them said that if the young lady was not engaged to Mr. Wildover, she ought to be. He gathered from the talk at table one day that Mr. Wildover had been at Kimberley and at the Rand, and that he had made money either in gold or diamonds. He had not heard which it was. There was always a good deal of talk about diamonds or gold at table, and he had left off taking any interest in it. There were names bandied about which he had never troubled himself to remember. The people that were talked about were all millionaires, and they had all gone to Africa without shoes to their feet, if the talkers were to be believed. I went back to London firmly believing that Wildover was the man who had been seen walking with the murdered woman on Christmas Eve. The steamer had arrived at Southampton early on that day, and Wildover had gone ashore with the other passengers, and his luggage, which was much less than the average quantity, was carried on shore soon after. He had only a cabin trunk and a kit bag. The steward knew nothing of his movements after he left the ship, but he concluded that, like most passengers, he went straight on to Waterloo. I was of the same opinion. He had gone to Waterloo, and had made his appointment with that unhappy young woman by wire, late in the afternoon. When Mrs. Delamere heard her moving about her room, she was dressing herself to go out and meet the man from Africa. That was between 6 and 7 o'clock, and it was not till 6 hours afterwards that they had paced the street, engaged in a conversation that was full of trouble, tears, reproaches, recriminations, distress. I was able, through the General Post Office, to get a copy of the telegram delivered to Mrs. Rayner on Christmas Eve. It was brief, and without name or initials. "Meet me in front of the British Museum at 8 o'clock. Your friend from Africa." Next came the consideration of motive. The story as I read it was clear enough. Here was a young man who had made his fortune in the colonies, coming home to enjoy life under the best possible conditions – youth, health, and plenty of money. For his companion on board ship, he had a girl whom he liked well enough to give his fellow passengers the idea that he and she were engaged lovers. So far, all was sunshine for Mr. Wildover. But round his neck hung the millstone of a cast-off mistress, a woman who had suffered poverty and deprivation, and kept herself honest for his sake. A woman who loved him well enough to be desperate, and who might become his persecutor if he threw her over and married somebody else. My experiences of life had shown me how heavy these millstones are, and what risks a man will run to get rid of one. Wildover met Lisa Rayner, therefore, with the idea of a compromise. He told her that he didn't mean to marry her, and he gave her a sum of money, perhaps with the promise to provide for her during the rest of her life. Now, if this man had intended murder, he would hardly have been so besotted as to give his victim a parcel of bank paper, which was calculated to lead to his identification. Notes on a local bank. Notes endorsed with name and date. The indications in a paper chase could scarcely be plainer. No. When he gave her that money, he thought he was buying her silence. He hoped to pacify her by his liberality. But then came their final interview, and this poor wretch was still harping on the same string. "I believed you would keep your promise." Besides tears and reproaches, there may have been threats of exposure. A blackmailer would have been bad enough, but a woman whom money wouldn't appease was worse. A millstone of the most dangerous kind. The man lost his temper. A big, strong, passionate brute. A man who had seen the roughest side of life, civilised and uncivilised. Who had lived in a miner's hut and herded with the Afrikaners and Kaffirs. A man of that class would be likely to carry a Smith & Wesson in his back pocket, having so shortly landed in England, and not yet abandoned his African habits. And this man lost his temper with the woman who claimed him, urging a claim that was unreasonable, perhaps, from a man's point of view. There may have been some final words on the doorstep, an entreaty on his part, a refusal on hers. And then he settled his course on the instant, followed her into the house and upstairs, shot her through the head, would, perhaps, have tried to recover the notes, had not the sound of opening doors warned him that he had no time to lose. The audacity of the crime gives it a certain interest. A bold, resolute, daredevil brute, evidently, this gentleman from South Africa. Having made up my mind that the man who gave Lisa Rayner the notes was the man who killed her, my immediate business was to find him and get him locked up. And in order to do this, and to fill in the links that were wanting in the chain of evidence, I had to trace the South African notes. The easiest way of doing this was to go to the London branch of the bank in Threadneedle Street, where I had a satisfactory interview with the manager, whom I was lucky enough to find at home in his rooms over the bank, and who undertook to cable the Johannesburg manager for all particulars he could obtain about the endorser of the notes, Philip Arden, ascertaining, if possible, to whom and on what day they were paid by the said Arden. That he should have written the date, December 2nd, below his signature, was a point in our favour. This inquiry being put in hand, my next business was to track my man from the moment he met his victim, at, say, between 7 and 8 o'clock on Christmas Eve, in front of the British Museum. To help me in this investigation, I had only one piece of evidence, the paper bag from the fruiterer in Covent Garden. Wherever they had spent their evening, whether in a theatre or music hall, or in any less innocent place, they had been in Covent Garden, and had been in Jakin's shop. It was Boxing Day and bank holiday, so I was not surprised to find the gardener desert and Jakin's shop closely shut. The class of people who were buying fruit were the class who buy it off barrows in the streets, so Mr. Jakin's could afford to treat himself to an holiday. London was a stony solitude, a wilderness of iron shutters. But with the murder of Lisa Rayner on my mind, I didn't feel up to holiday-making, so I loafed about the neighbourhood of Covent Garden most of Boxing Day, and took my chop at a quiet hotel hard by. Now, when I loaf, there's generally a motive in my loafing, and I was hanging about that neighbourhood on the chance of discovering my gentleman from Africa, or, at any rate, the hotel at which he had put himself up when he came to London. As to the man himself, in all probability he was out of London, and meant to get across the sea again as soon as he could. The ports were being taken care of, and he wouldn't find it very easy to leave England. The only difficulty was the chance of half a dozen wrong men being arrested, his description being somewhat vague. He had not come to London intending to commit a murder, and he had behaved as any other traveller would have done. He had gone to an hotel, a young man's hotel most likely, since according to the steward's reckoning he was about 30 years of age, and therefore must have left England a young man. There were three hotels within a short distance of the garden, much affected by Varsity and other young men, and at these I looked for traces of Mr. Wildover. I did not find him by name, but at the quietest of the three houses I found distinct traces of such a man, and, what was more to the point, found that after arriving at the hotel in an hansom with a cabin trunk and kit bag, this gentleman had engaged a room and had gone out again almost immediately, not returning till long after midnight, when only the night porter was up to give him his candle and show him the way to his room. I saw the night porter, who described the gentleman as looking white and worried, not at all like a gentleman who had been enjoying himself at a place of entertainment.
"He asked me to get him a glass of brandy, and was put out when I told him the bar was locked up for the night, and everybody was gone to bed."
Had he noticed the time when he let the gentleman into the house, and did he come in a cab or on foot?
on foot. Leastways, I heard no cab stop.
Time, 1:30. You were asleep, perhaps?
No, the porter assured me. He was sitting in the hall, reading a newspaper.
So much for Mr. Wildover's return to the hotel on Christmas Eve. The other servants were able to tell me about his departure from the hotel on Christmas morning after breakfasting in the coffee room. A cool hand, Mr. Wildover, to sit down to breakfast in a public room, red-handed from a brutal murder. He left the hotel before noon in an hansom, carrying his kit bag and leaving his trunk in the bedroom. I took the liberty of examining this trunk, which was not locked, and which, as I anticipated, contained nothing that would help me in my investigation, only a suit of well-worn tweed and a stock of colonial underclothing. It was a shabby old wooden trunk, and the initials A.W. in red paint were nearly rubbed off, but still recognisable. He carried his revolver in his pocket, most likely, unless he had been cautious enough to drop it over one of the bridges before he went back to the hotel. Time, however, was against the latter supposition, if, as the porter stated, Wildover was in the hotel at 1:30. I asked the man who had waited upon him a few questions. Had he seemed well and in good spirits? Had he eaten a good breakfast?
First class, said the waiter. Ordered a follow of eggs and bacon, said our London rations wouldn't feed a South African. Whistled and walked about as cheery as you like, a-looking at Bradshaw, a-smoking like 1 o'clock. And to think that he should be wanted, Mr. Faunce. Is it forgery now?
I am pretty well known about town, and the head waiter at Spavin's Hotel is an old acquaintance, but I try to keep him in his place. No, James, it ain't forgery, and I never told you the gentleman was wanted.
Well, but you come here to look for him, sir. That's tantiment, you know.
James is a terrible fellow for fine words, which he generally mispronounces and often misapplies. I have come to look for a gentleman, James, I answered, but I am far from concluding that this is the man I want.
Well, sir, any help I can give you?
Thank you, James. You are always obliging. You saw the gentleman into his hansom. What station?
Liverpool Street.
Antwerp or Flushing, thought I. Antwerp for choice, and then America.
Did the gentleman say he was coming back?
Yes, sir. Keep my room and take care of my trunk, says he. When might he be coming back, sir, says I.
I might be coming back tomorrow, he makes answer, but it ain't likely. It may be next day or next week. You can keep my room.
You may keep it till the day of judgment, I fancy, James, and the owner won't give you any trouble about it, said I.
Then you think he's your man?
Cried James eagerly. If he is my man, he's on the sea by this time, or he's caught at Harwich or at Queenborough, said I, and you will never see any more of him unless you're asked to look at him at Bow Street. But I'm not by any means sure that he is my man, and all you've got to do is to hold your tongue till you're wanted.
He paid his bill, I suppose?
Yes, he had paid his bill, and had tipped James handsomely, I gathered, which tip did not in the least diminish the waiter's desire to earn an honest penny by getting him arrested for felony. The likely seaports were being watched, and any man answering Wildover's description would be detained. So I was easy on that point, and expected to find a wire at the office announcing his arrest. There were no wires. I went home to a late dinner, after telegraphing special instructions to Harwich and Queenborough. there would be a close watch kept on outgoing passengers at both places. If Liverpool Street meant flight, his Christmas journey had not helped Mr. Wildover. I saw Jakins, the fruiterer, early on Thursday morning. He remembered selling some hothouse grapes, which were scarce and dear at Christmas, to a tall man in a rough overcoat and wearing a brown bowler hat. There was a woman with him, youngish but worn-looking. She looked like a lady, but was very plainly dressed, like a lady who had gone down in the world. Jakins took notice of these two because his shop was empty, and he was just going to shut up when they came in, and partly on account of the man buying grapes at that price. He didn't look the style of customer for hothouse grapes at 9 shillings a pound, not in that frieze coat and bowler hat, but he chucked his half-sovereign on the counter and handed the grapes to the young woman as careless as if they'd been Portugals at 1 and 3. Asked to describe the man, Jakins repeated Phoebe Miller's description: a dark complexion, sunburnt, a light brown beard. Height over 6 feet, perhaps as much as 6 feet 2, broad shoulders, a fine-looking man. Anybody would have noticed him. He hadn't the look of a Londoner. Asked if he overheard any conversation between the man and woman while they were in his shop, Jakins replied that they were talking to each other confidential-like while he was weighing the grapes, but that the only words he caught were Covent Garden and concert, and "you was always so fond of music," which it was him made the remark to her, Jakins said. After this I had no doubt that they had gone to the theatre hard by, where I knew there had been a promenade concert on Christmas Eve. Asked if he could say what o'clock it was when these people were in his shop, Jakins was doubtful. Couldn't say within half an hour, but thought it would be close upon 9, as 9 o'clock was his time for putting up the shutters. Then, thought I, they had dined somewhere, Andy. It would be only natural, with this great brute flush of money, and hoping to wheedle his victim into foregoing all claim upon him, should start by giving her a good dinner. They were to meet in front of the museum, on that broad pavement outside the railings, quiet spot, and within 10 minutes' walk of her lodgings. Then came the question, where would he take her to dine? If they walked westward, there was the Horseshoe, a likely place for Wildover to have known in the past. If they crossed Holborn and went towards Covent Garden, there was no restaurant worth speaking of nearer than the Strand. I tried the Horseshoe first, but made nothing by my inquiries. The rooms were too full of diners for any particular party to be noticed. They'd have had to have been Cherokees in paint and feathers for any of us to have remarked 'em, the waiter said. It really mattered very little where the two had dined, as I had made out their evening pretty well, and I relied upon Jakins to identify the man. Only it was my habit not to leave time unaccounted for, so I was sorry not to be able to trace their movements between 8 o'clock, when they were to have met, and 9 o'clock, when or about when they were at the fruiterer's. After I had left the Horseshoe, I walked along Tottenham Court Road with my face to the north, in a leisurely meditative mood. There was no pressure upon me to superhuman exertion, for I could do very little till I received information from Johannesburg, and in the meantime, if Wildover came within range, I meant to put him in safe keeping. There was evidence enough to justify his arrest. Strolling along, I caught sight of an Italian restaurant on the opposite side of the way, an insignificant little place, which I had often noticed but never had occasion to enter. Carlo somebody. Coffee, chocolate, ices, the usual placards, a few cakes in the window. I knew that even at the most insignificant of these places one might get a beef steak and fried potatoes, and a dish of macaroni with tomatoes, and that the proprietor will send out of doors for any liquor that is ordered. The man from Africa may have chosen just such a place. It lay well within his ken if he came out of Great Russell Street. I crossed the road and was soon on good terms with one of the two Swiss waiters. It was early in the afternoon. There was only one customer in the long, narrow shop, a lady of the music teacher or typewriter species, taking a cup of chocolate and a sponge cake at one of the marble-topped tables and spelling over a flabby little French newspaper. Yes, it was here they had dined, in this modest retreat, at a table at the inner end of the room. A tall, broad-shouldered man of about 30, good-looking, sunburned, light brown beard. Both the waiters were able to describe him. He had ordered the best dinner they could serve at once. He was very hungry and impatient, and he had given them a sovereign to send out for a bottle of champagne, and he had given the best mancha André had received this Christmas, and they had given him a good dinner. Fricandeau de veau à l'osée, le plat de jour, œuf poché aux épinards, beefsteak aux pommes, rouillé compote de prune. A regular Christmas dinner. Had André observed this lady and gentleman while he waited upon them? Naturally, he had observed them much. They were the only customers who had ordered a little careful dinner, or who had sent for champagne. Monsieur was evidently not the first comer. Yes, André had observed them. The poor lady had a melancholy air, yet by fits and starts was joyous, and her cheeks flushed, and her eyes shone as she looked at her handsome friend. Once she held out her hand and clasped his across the little table, not without tears. She hardly ate anything, and took only one glass of champagne. She seemed too full of emotion, poor lady, to eat much. The gentleman ate heartily, but he also seemed agitated, and did not appreciate the fricandeau as so excellent a dish deserved. Once André surprised Madame in tears. It was when he handed the pâtisseries. Monsieur motioned the dish away, brusquement, with an angry gesture. In André's opinion, they were a married couple who had agreed to separate, and who faisait la fête at their last dinner. Ça avait l'air d'un adieu. J'ai soupçonné même qu'on songeait à se suicider. They had left the little Italian restaurant towards 9, André told me. So now I had their evening laid out like a map, for I had very little doubt that they had gone straight from the fruiterer's to Covent Garden Theatre. And then, when the concert was over, towards midnight, he had walked home with her. It was a fine evening, exceptionally mild for the season, mild as October. They had walked to Dynevor Street, and perhaps only there, during the walk, in the quiet of after midnight, had he disclosed his intention of breaking with her altogether, this man whom she had welcomed home with such rapture. Then had come that final conversation while they were walking up and down the street, in which she, poor creature, found how obdurate he was, and during which her distress became uncontrollable. I believe that it was during this last conversation that he gave her the banknotes. The manner in which I found them, loosely folded, thrust inside the bodice of her gown, indicated that she had put them there carelessly,
scarcely knowing what she did. Poverty, such as hers, would not handle £120 so carelessly, except under peculiar conditions. I asked Andre and his fellow servant if they would know the man we were talking of among half a dozen other men. Andre protested he would know him among 100. Identification in the case of Wildover was therefore easy enough up to a certain point. But what witness could I find to connect the woman who was his companion with that poor soul whose disfigured face the coroner's jury were to look upon tomorrow? Only Phoebe Miller, who knew Lisa Rayner by sight, and who can swear to having seen her walking up and down Dynevor Street with a man 10 minutes before the murder. If Phoebe should falter in her recognition of the man, the whole case against Wildover, as it now stands, must break down. I may succeed in connecting him with the notes I found in her bosom, but unless I can show him in company with the woman herself, there is no chance of a committal. The inquest afforded no new evidence of any kind, and passed off very quietly. The public mind has not yet awakened to the sensational features of this crime, or it may be that the public mind is temporarily obscured by turkey and sausages. There was no crowd in the coroner's room, at a tavern near Dynevor Street, and the two reporters I saw there looked half asleep. Yet I have not the slightest doubt that in a week's time the Dynevor Street murder will have taken the town by storm and become the leading topic in all the daily papers. For cool audacity, the man from Africa surpasses anybody who ever came under my notice, always supposing him to be the murderer. I was startled at my breakfast this morning by a telegram from the head waiter at Spavin's Hotel. "Wildover returned late last night, leaving today." I called at Bow Street for one of my best men and went to the hotel. I was only just in time. There was a four-wheeler at the door, and Mr. Wildover's kit bag was on the roof, while Mr. Wildover himself stood in the doorway, objurgating against the sloth of the boots for not bringing his trunk. "That fellow will make me lose my train," he cried, "and if I lose my train I shall lose my steamer, and that means a fortnight's delay." "You seem in a great hurry to leave England, sir," I said. He looked at me from head to foot in the coolest way. He was not by any means the rough brute I had pictured him. He is a good-looking fellow, with a pleasant countenance. But I have seen a pleasant countenance before today with a murderer's brain behind it. "What business is it of yours if I'm in a hurry to leave your cursed London?" he said. "Is that luggage coming?" he shouted, scowling back at the hall. As he opened the cab door, Boots brought the trunk, moving at a leisurely pace. He had been held back by my friend the waiter. "I'm sorry to say that it is very much my business to prevent your starting for Africa," said I, "for I have to take you in custody on suspicion of being concerned in the Dynevor Street murder." He turned a ghastly white, bold as he may be. "Oh," he said, as cool as a cucumber. After a few moments' consideration, "Then I suppose I'd better go with you." "Well, you've no alternative. This cab will do for us all. Get on the box, Sergeant, and look after Mr. Wildover's luggage." When we were seated in the cab, I gave him the usual warning, but he hardly seemed to require it. He only spoke twice between the hotel and Bow Street, in the first place to beg me to put him into a clean cell. "I'm used to roughing it,"
he said, "but I can't stand dirt." I told him that as he was arrested upon suspicion, he would be allowed certain indulgences, such as having his meals sent from outside, for instance. He glared at me like a demon. "Meals!" he cried. "Do you suppose I shall care about eating and drinking in that degrading position?" And that was his second and final remark. End of chapter 6.
Chapter 7 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 7. At Bow Street. Fog and gloom in the court within, and fog and gloom in the street without, marked the beginning of an adjourned examination before the Bow Street magistrate, in which Arnold Wentworth, otherwise Alfred Wildover, played the leading part. To that court and the newspapers, and to the outside world interested in the Dynevor Street murder, he was Wildover still. The name of Wentworth was so far undamaged by the adventures of the black sheep of the family. He had changed Christian and surname 5 years ago, when the struggle for bread began in London. It was as Alfred Wildover that he took a weekly wage at the South London Music Hall, and it was as Alfred Wildover that he took his passage on the Saxon, and had given his name as Alfred Wildover after his arrest. So, as his mother had never heard that name, it was hardly likely that she would associate the man under suspicion of a brutal murder with her son, unless, indeed, Mary Freeland had told her of his alias. But as the days of his captivity wore on, there had been no sign from Mervynhall, and he was, therefore, assured that his mother was spared the knowledge of his degrading position. He had given her no address, had planned no second meeting with her. To see her and talk with her for an hour, and to know that she was well and tolerably happy, had satisfied his filial yearnings in his unsettled state of mind and uncertain future. And now he looked back at that interview, and was thankful that circumstances had so shaped themselves as to leave all the details of his life in shadow. There could be no obvious link to connect Alfred Wildover with Arnold Wentworth. The fact that the suspected murderer had newly arrived from the Cape could have no significance in days when the intercourse between England and South Africa is a matter of daily occurrence. Someone had interested himself, or herself, in his fate, and had shown that interest in a very substantial manner. He had been asked if he wanted to engage a solicitor to watch his case, and to defend him, and he had said no. He believed the plain truth would do more for him than any legal sophistry. He wanted no advocate. But on the day following his first brief appearance before the magistrate, a gentleman was ushered into his cell, who announced himself as Mr. Chilbrick, a solicitor of some standing, but chiefly known in the criminal courts. This unexpected visitor, who was received not too civilly, proceeded to explain that he had been retained to watch the case for Mr. Wildover by a friend, who wished him well. "Be kind enough to tell me my friend's name," said Arnold. "I don't like anonymous benefits. I fear the Greeks and their gifts, if I don't know who the Greeks are." "Be assured you have no cause for fear in this instance, Mr. Wildover. Your friend is a very good friend, who, hearing that you were undefended, and had refused to avail yourself of professional help, called upon me and engaged my services in your behalf. It would be a bad return for that friend's kindness if you were to refuse my assistance." Arnold moved restlessly in his chair, blushed like a girl, and smiled with a look half sad, half tender, which Mr. Chilbrick knew meant yielding. "I have not many friends in England," he said. "I think I can guess the name of this one, and I am not ungrateful for her kindness. God bless her." He glanced at the solicitor to see how he took this assertion of his client's sex. But Mr. Chilbrick's countenance presented a polite mask, which could not have been more impenetrable had it been marble. Mr. Chilbrick's interview with Arnold, following on this conversation, was long, and from the solicitor's point of view, most unsatisfactory. The client was pig-headed in the extreme, and wanted to defend himself, or, at any rate, to be defended only in his own way. The second interview made things no better. "You don't seem to know that there is a very strong prima facie case against you," said Chilbrick. "I know that I didn't shoot her. The onus is upon the prosecution to prove me guilty, and the onus is upon you to prevent their doing it." The first appearance of the prisoner in Bow Street had been merely formal in compliance with the law. Faunce had asked for a remand as the case was not yet complete. He had an important piece of evidence which he was not yet ready to produce, and to go into the matter without that evidence would be to waste the time of the court. So, after a formal setting out of bare facts, the case was adjourned, the prisoner's application for bail being peremptorily refused, although he was ready to lodge securities for £1,000 with the magistrate. And now, after 7 days and nights of impatience, irritation, and weariness for the man from Africa, the case was pronounced ripe for hearing, and Alfred Wildover made his second appearance in any court of justice. That second appearance of his was not calculated to create a favorable impression. He looked haggard, worn out, ill at ease, and irritable. The cool, frank outlook which had surprised Faunce was gone. A weak endurance vile, with the restrictions and discipline to which he had been subjected, had shaken him more than all his hard labor and rough living at Kimberley and the Rand. Mr. Davenant, a member of the junior bar, prosecuted for the Treasury. Mr. Chilbrick, solicitor, defended. The sergeant who had been called immediately after the murder was the first witness. He described the state of the room when he entered it, and the position of the murdered woman. He was followed by Mr. Faunce, who put in a plan of the room in which the murder was committed, and the landing and staircase, and gave a more detailed account of everything. He described the finding of the German Testament, the fruiterer's bag, and lastly, the bundle of notes which had been since identified by communication with the Johannesburg branch of the South African Banking Company, through their London office, as notes which had been given to the Honorable Philip Arden in exchange for his check 4 days before the sailing of the Saxon. The notes were endorsed by Mr. Arden more fully than usual, as he had written the date below his signature. Further inquiry at Johannesburg had shown that the notes had been paid to the prisoner for a wagon and team of bullocks with articles useful in a shooting expedition. The transaction had taken place at the hotel where Mr. Arden was staying, and the landlord had been a witness of purchase and payment. The man from Africa heard this latter part of the evidence with a look of angry impatience. The description of the murdered woman's appearance had moved him strongly. If he were the rough brute Faunce believed him, he was not altogether without human feeling. Mr. Chilbrick did not cross-examine the sergeant or the detective, nor did he take any objection to the cabled evidence from South Africa. The Dynevor Street murder had by this time begun, in the language of the music hall, to catch on. The reporters were on the alert for sensational evidence and highly colored detail. Each man, after his kind, had jotted down a graphic description of the prisoner. While the swift, firm strokes of accomplished pencils were doing all that modern art can do to fix the figures of the passing hour. Magistrate, lawyers, witnesses, detectives, and the prisoner in the dock would all be hawked about London by bawling newsboys tonight and tomorrow, to be scattered to the winds the day after. And now the pencillers became newly alert, for the feminine element was to give a zest to the proceedings. Suddenly, as from the witch's cauldron, there rose in the witness-box an agreeable vision of a sealskin jacket, the smallest and most Parisian thing in bonnets, an alabaster complexion under a spotted veil, and the newest shade of Titianesque hair, while across the fetid atmosphere of a metropolitan police court floated a delicate odor of essence bouquet. The witness was a lady who was living in the house at the time of the murder, but who had since removed to St. George's Terrace, Brompton Road. The lady was known as Mrs. Delamere. "Is that your real name?" Mr. Davenant asked. The witness rather reluctantly admitted that Delamere was not her name. It was the name, or possibly the alias, of a gentleman friend who had been acquainted with her father, and who paid her rent, and was indeed her guardian. At least she had always looked upon him in that light. The lady was sworn as Anne Wilson, and after the counsel for the Treasury had elicited a plain statement of fact, she was taken in hand by Mr. Chilbrick. "It was you who gave the first alarm, I think, after the firing of the pistol."
"I don't know. Mrs. Grogan was on the landing before you could say knife."
"But not before the man who fired the shot was able to get off unseen."
"I beg your pardon. I saw him go downstairs."
"Are you able to describe him?"
"No, I ain't. His back was towards me."
"Was he tall or short, stout or thin?"
"I don't know. I was frightened, and he was running downstairs. There was no light but the candle in my hand."
"Then you cannot tell us what he was like in any particular. His dress, for instance. Did he look like a gentleman or a mechanic?"
"He was in his ordinary clothes."
"Was he wearing an overcoat?"
"I think so."
"Not a fustian jacket?"
"No, I am sure of that. If I had time to think about him at all, I thought he was a gentleman."
"Did you notice the color of his coat?"
"Not particularly. It was dark. That's all I know about it."
"Will you tell us exactly what happened? Were you awakened by the shot?"
"No, I was lying awake. I am a wretched sleeper, and that was one of my bad nights."
"You had not been in bed very long, perhaps?"
"No, I was rather late home that night. I had been to a place of amusement."
"I will not ask you to name the place of amusement." This remark and the last question were aimed at the gallery, and a suppressed titter further enlivened the dreariness of the police court. "Well, you were lying awake. What was the first thing that attracted your attention?"
"It was footsteps coming upstairs."
"Was that such an unusual occurrence?"
"No. Mrs. Rayner had a latch key, and she was often out of a night wandering about. Not for any wrong purpose, poor thing, but because she couldn't bear herself indoors. She used to get the horrors sitting alone, she told me."
"Oh, she used to get the horrors sitting alone. I conclude she was living pretty much the same easy kind of life as yours."
"You have no call to talk about my life. I'm not here to answer impudent questions. As for her life, it was honest enough and wretched enough, and it was nearer death than life at the best."
"Well, you heard her come in. Did you notice the time?"
"Yes, it was 1:05.
"How came you to be so precise?"
"Because I keep a clock on the table by my bed with a nightlight in front of it, and I looked at the clock as I heard her footsteps go up the stairs, and I wondered at her being so late. That's how I come to be so precise."
There was a faint murmur among the audience as of approval. "Well, you heard her go upstairs alone?"
"Yes, and 2 minutes afterwards I heard a man's footsteps on the stairs following hers. He trod very softly, but still I could tell it was a man, and I wondered that she should bring anybody into the house at such an hour."
"You thought it was too respectable a house for nocturnal visitors?"
"I knew it was a respectable house, or I shouldn't have been living in it." Perhaps you thought she had found an old friend of her father's to pay her rent. Well, what next?
I heard the report of a pistol.
How long after the man's footsteps had passed your door?
Not 2 minutes. Only long enough for him to have gone up the stairs to the third floor.
And how long was it before you were on the landing?
Hardly a minute. I am very chilly, and I had gone to bed in my dressing gown. I waited only to put my feet in my slippers and light my candle before I went to see what had happened. The man was halfway down to the first floor. I just caught sight of him over the banisters. Mrs. Grogan sleeps in the third floor front, and she came out in her nightgown and was on the landing screaming murder as I went up. Mrs. Raynor's door was open, and me and Mrs. Grogan went into her room together. She was lying on the floor, shot through the head. A dreadful spectacle.
The witness burst into tears and became slightly hysterical. Some water was brought, and the magistrate begged her to sit down and rest for a few minutes before continuing her evidence. When she had recovered from a very natural agitation, and had rearranged her spotted veil over a complexion which had lost somewhat of its alabaster whiteness, the interrogation went on. "I believe you were very kind to the deceased, and knew more about her than anyone else in the house."
"Nobody else ever did anything for her. I'd have been kinder if she'd have let me. But she was very proud. It was very difficult to get her to take bite or sup, though it was plain enough she was half-starved."
"Did she tell you anything about her antecedents?"
"Her family, do you mean?"
"Yes, her family," smiling a little at having used a word out of the witness's range. "Her early days, belongings, the circumstances that had brought her to such a pass."
"No, she was a rare one to hold her tongue. She never told me anything about herself. But I think she must have been brought up a lady. She never talked of herself but once. It was one night that she seemed ready to drop, and I made her take some spirits and water, and it got into her head. And she was half wild-like, and cried, and talked about herself. And she told me that she had never loved but 2 men. One who was rich, and who led her wrong, and deceived her, and left her to starve. And one who was nearly as poor as she was, and who was good to her. She loved the rich man when she was little more than a child, and was deceived by the first kind words that had ever been spoken to her. She loved the poor man when she was a woman, and him she would love till her dying day, though they had parted years ago, and might never meet again."
This closed Mr. Chilbrick's cross-examination. The servant girl at No. 13 Dynevor Street was the next witness. She gave her evidence as to the arrival of the telegram for Mrs. Raynor, and a copy of the telegram was produced, and sworn to by a clerk from the post office. "Meet me in front of the British Museum tonight at 8. Your friend from Africa. Received at King Street at 6:40. Phoebe Miller, the maid of all work at No. 16, was next sworn, and repeated the statement she had made to Faunce, but was weak under cross-examination, and was not certain as to the identity of the prisoner with the man she had seen walking with Lisa Raynor. The next witness was the waiter from the Italian restaurant, who had identified the prisoner previously on seeing him in a group of other men, and who described his conduct and that of the woman with him while he waited on them. He described the woman's appearance and the emotion she had exhibited at one period of the meal. In the midst of Mr. Davenant's examination of this witness, Mr. Chilbrick addressed the magistrate. "It would save your time and trouble, sir, if I state that my client has no desire to deny his identity with the person who was seen in Mrs. Raynor's company as late as 1:50 on the night of December the 24th. This admission brought the proceedings to an abrupt check. There was no occasion to work any further along the line of Faunce's investigation. But since his researches of Christmas Day and Bank Holiday, the chief inspector had become aware of a circumstance which might have a close connection with the crime in Dynevor Street, and he had his witnesses ready. The first of these witnesses was a cook in the service of a clergyman in Gordon Square, who swore to finding a pistol in the area early in the morning on the 26th of December.
Did you sweep the area on Christmas Day? No, the family was dining out, and me and the housemaid was allowed to have a friend each to spend the afternoon, so I left the cleaning up till Boxing Day.
And on Boxing Day you found this pistol?
The pistol was on the table in front of the magistrate. Was it lying where anyone might see it from the street?
I don't think anyone could have seen it. Missus and the vicar are great ones for creepers, and the ivy grows all over the end of the area, and the pistol had fallen in a corner right among the ivy. I mightn't have found it myself if I hadn't hit it with my broom. Anyone could have put his arm between the railings and slipped the pistol down behind the ivy.
And what did you do with the pistol?
I took it upstairs to my room.
Did it not occur to you that it was your duty to inform the police of such a suspicious circumstance, or to tell your master what had happened?
I wanted to show the pistol to a friend of mine first,
but you finally concluded you ought to tell your master.
When I heard such a lot of talk about the Dynevor Street murder, I thought the pistol might be the one that's done it.
Did you know whether the pistol was loaded?
No, but I thought it might be, and I tied it up in a handkerchief and put it on the top shelf of a cupboard where it couldn't have hurt no one if it had gone off.
You did very wrong to conceal such a discovery, the magistrate remarked in a voice that withered the cook from Gordon Square. You must be perfectly aware that pistols are not commonly found in the areas of London houses. The next witness was a gunsmith, who had compared the bullet found in the murdered woman's room with the pistol. All the chambers of which were loaded, except one containing a discharged cartridge case, when the cook handed it to the constable. Bullet and pistol fitted. Mr. Chilbrick did not cross-examine either witness, but he begged for a further remand on the ground that he had been unprepared for this evidence. The magistrate consented, and the inquiry was adjourned for a week. The adjourned proceedings opened with the evidence of a witness whose presence there had been procured by Mr. Chilbrick's energetic efforts during the week's respite. This witness was the assistant of a well-known gunmaker in Holborn. He identified the revolver produced in court as the one he had sold on the 22nd of the previous November to a young man who paid for it across the counter and took it away with him. Asked if the purchaser was the prisoner, he replied,
"Certainly not. Not a bit like him."
"Can you describe the person's appearance?"
"He was not so tall as the prisoner. A tallish man, but not as tall as the prisoner by 3 or 4 inches. He was dressed like a gentleman, but not fashionably, in a rather careless style. He had what one might call a studious look, and was wearing dark blue spectacles."
"You had no suspicion of any bad motive in his purchase?"
"Oh, dear, no. We should have nothing to do but suspect bad motives if we suspected every purchaser of a revolver. He said something about going to British Columbia, and was expecting to fall in with a rough lot there. He was one of your communicative customers. I didn't listen to him except so far as the business went. He wanted a pistol of the finest quality, small enough for him to carry in his trouser pocket, and I chose that one for him as the best and handiest.
Beyond the fact that the bullet found in Dynevor Street corresponded exactly with this pistol, there was the further evidence of the cartridges, which were of a new make, and identified by the gunsmith as the kind he had supplied with the pistol.
Mr. Chilbrick, cross-examining, did anything strike you as curious in the spectacles the man wore?
Witness, they hid more of his eyes and forehead than the common kind of spectacles, and I imagined that he was a sufferer from some kind of eye disease.
Mr. Chilbrick, what time of day was he in your shop?
Witness, I can't name the precise hour, but it was towards evening. The afternoon was foggy, and there had been no one in the shop except Lord Humberley's valet, who ordered some cartridges for Scotland.
Mr. Chilbrick,
you had had a leisurely afternoon, then?
Witness,
yes. I should hardly have remembered the sale of the revolver. It was entered in our books, of course, or the appearance of the man, if it had been one of our busy days. The fog was keeping all our usual customers at home.
Mr. Chilbrick, look at the prisoner again. Now, Are you quite sure you never saw him before? Witness, quite sure. After the examination of this witness, the counsel for the Treasury closed the case and put in a statement written by the accused while under detention and handed to the governor of the prison. It was the following plain and straightforward recital of the circumstances which had brought the man from Africa to that dock. Lisa Rayner was a friend whom I had lost sight of for many years. My first years in Africa were so unlucky, and I was so hopeless of ever prospering there, that I had not had heart enough to write to her. What was the use of writing to say, "I am starving here, and perhaps you are starving in London"? When the tide turned and I began to prosper, I wrote, and only waited her reply to send her money. But no letter of mine reached her. She had been driven from pillar to post in the interval. I heard from her just before I left the gold fields. Her letter had been waiting for me at Heidelberg for months, while I was amusing myself in Bechuana land. She wrote to me that she was unhappy and in great poverty, and my first act on reaching London was to appoint a meeting with her. We met at 8 o'clock in Great Russell Street, as the witness Faunce stated. We dined together, and then I took her to Covent Garden, where there was a concert, and where we sat in a back row of the upper circle. It was nearly midnight when the concert was over, and I walked to Dynevor Street with her. We walked slowly and lingered a little on the way, having a good deal to talk about, and our conversation was not finished when we came to Dynevor Street, so I walked up and down the street with her, between two turnings, as the girl Miller described. It was during this conversation that I gave her the African notes, which she was reluctant to accept. We parted at the door of number 13. She opened the door with her latch-key some minutes before we parted, and she came down the steps again to speak to me. We stood talking by the area railings during those last few minutes, but whether it would have been possible for anyone to go in at that door after she had opened it, unperceived by either of us, is more than I can say. We were both agitated. She was distressed, and I was troubled by her distress. I had given her a promise before I went to the Cape 4 years ago, and circumstances had occurred that made it impossible for me to keep that promise. I was very sorry for her, and I wanted to be her friend, and to make her future life as happy as a friend's help could make it. Mr. Chilbrick briefly reviewed the case against his client, and made a defense which, taken in conjunction with the gunsmith's evidence, and with Wildover's straightforward statement, went a long ways toward procuring an immediate discharge. The inquiry was, however, adjourned for a week, to give time for further revelations. Bail was again applied for, and again refused, and Arnold was taken back to Pentonville angry and almost despairing. End of Chapter 7. Chapter 8 of Rough Justice. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Mary Herndon Bell. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 8. A Death Blow. No new evidence was forthcoming at the adjourned examination in the magistrate's court, and after some verbal fencing between Mr. Davenant for the Treasury and Mr. Chilbrick for the prisoner, the magistrate, having briefly reviewed the whole of the circumstances, did not feel justified in remitting the case to a jury. The accused, Alfred Wildover, was discharged, and Arnold Wentworth, like one awakening from a hideous dream, found himself at liberty to leave that place of despair. He thanked Mr. Chilbrick, and begged him to convey an unlucky man's gratitude to his unknown friend, and having shaken hands with the solicitor, and handsomely tipped his custodians, he left that place, as he hoped, for ever. He was a free man once more, and the world seemed a new world. Even the bleak London streets were enchanting. Swept by a biting March wind, pervaded by the city's dust, flavored with sewage, smoke, and an unclean population. Yes, Even that howling wilderness of brick and stone seemed paradise to the man who had been enduring an ignominious captivity. He flung his arms about. He walked with buoyant step. He held his head as loftily as if he had succeeded to a dukedom. He had come into possession of man's best inheritance, liberty, and the sense of freedom was ecstasy. Mary, little Mary, otherwise the kid. His first thought after self-congratulation was about Mary Freeland. He was eager to see her, to thank her for her goodness to a friend in distress, if, as he had little doubt, it was she who had sent the solicitor. It must be she, and none other. Even had his mother discovered his identity with the accused Wildover, it was not within the compass of her mind or means to take so bold a step. What did Mrs. Wentworth know of criminal lawyers? Her intellect had been blunted by continual encounters with that awe-inspiring personage, the professed cook. Soups, entrees, ices, etc. The etc. standing for failures and disappointments. He had Mary's address in his pocketbook, given to him that December morning at the Briary, when he stood before her, white to the lip, after reading of the murder in Dynevor Street, and had made some feeble excuse about a touch of African fever and sudden giddiness, while Mary scrawled Mrs. Smith's address in his pocketbook. "Be sure you come to see me when I am settled," she had said as she wrote. "I dare say, if you behave very nicely, Mrs. Tresillian Smith will send you a card for her parties. She may put you on her free list, and then you can come every week if you like." He had muttered something about the bliss of such parties, and had left her after wringing her hand in an agitated way that scared and puzzled her. How like a man to make such a fuss about a headache, she thought, and how could he talk of fever with that ice-cold hand? And now he had come through that black cloud of trouble and was free again, and that dark past might be as if it had never been. He had shed all his tears for the poor creature whose fate had been so hard. A broken life and a violent and mysterious death in the solitude and depression of his prison. He would put a slab of marble over Lisa Rayner's grave in Highgate Cemetery to bear record of her gentle, submissive life and unselfish love. And then surely his conscience would allow him to forget her tragic fate, and to remember only the days in which they had loved each other and been happy together. A higher kind of happiness was to be his in the future, he hoped, the happiness of union with a pure and guileless woman, his little Mary, his frank and joyous comrade, the woman out of whose eyes truth and courage looked with bright commanding glance, the conqueror whom his heart acknowledged as mistress and queen. In South Kensington there are long streets of stuccoed houses on which the sun never shines. These are called gardens. It may be, indeed, that on one favoured side of the way, and at one propitious hour, the sun does look, but the casual visitor rarely surprises Phoebus in the act. The long stony street, with its pillared porticos all alike, dwells for the most part in an atmosphere of neutral grey, which is scarcely enlivened by the genteel palms and india-rubber trees in the bay windows. An Italian grocer's shop, an Indian bazaar, a jutting Moorish sunblind, striped with vermilion and orange, might afford a relief to the gloom. Anything less vivid is futile. Hexton Gardens was of this order of architecture, and vainly had Mrs. Tresillian Smith's artistic fancy struggled against the pervading greyness, the yellowy green of the portiere between outer lobby and hall, and a beaded bamboo blind before a staircase window, testified to her ineffectual efforts. The gloomy impression of the street, which the visitor carried with him into the house, was not dispelled by such feeble colouring as came within the range of Mrs. Tresillian Smith's taste. Arnold's high spirits yielded to the genius of the place. He was feeling almost unhappy when he pressed the electric bell at number 19. He felt a gloom akin to despair when he found himself shut in by the black-coated manservant in the shadowy back room which Mrs. Tressilian Smith called her drawing-room, the two French windows of which were obscured by highly artistic muslin blinds of a sickly yellow and a slaty blue. "Poor Mary! If this is the liveliest room in the house, I pity her," thought Arnold. He felt as if he were within prison walls again. But the palms, the silver table on which the mustard pots and odd spoons of three generations were paraded, the gorgeous books, inkstands, and candlesticks on other tables, the Indian screen draped out of knowledge, the semi-grand piano muffled in a Japanese curtain, and the general air and manner of the room testified to its bestness. Evidently Mrs. Tressilian Smith's chief reception room, and a room of which she was proud. He sat 10 minutes in chilling solitude. The fire in the ornamental grate was a miserable fire, and gave neither flame nor heat. He had time in those 10 minutes to open and shut every volume on the loaded table, drawing-room books every one of them, gilded vellum, antique calf, red edges, gold edges, and nothing inside. Certainly nothing that he, Arnold, wanted to read. It was such a long 10 minutes, but Mary would come rushing in presently like living sunlight. Perhaps, in strict etiquette, he ought to have asked to see the lady of the house first, and her charge afterwards, he thought. But then the circumstances were exceptional. A man does not come out of prison every day. The door opened slowly. Not Mary's hand, surely. Yes, it was Mary Freeland. But she came towards him with lagging steps and a sorrow-stricken countenance, as of one in the house of death. She came about halfway across the room, and then stopped and stood looking at him, with no outstretched hand to welcome him, no smile upon her pale lip, no light in her eyes. "Mary, are you not glad to see me a free man again, cleared from that atrocious charge? Have you no good word for me? I came here hoping to find you half wild with joy, as I was when I came out of court a free man." "I don't think I shall ever know the meaning of the word joy again," she answered, standing before him like a statue. He put his hands upon her shoulders, as he had done on their first meeting on board the steamer. But this time those strong hands gripped her almost fiercely, and there was anger in the eyes which scrutinized her face. "My God! Can it be that you believe I murdered that woman?"
"I believe nothing. I am very miserable."
"You don't know me well enough. You, the child I used to play with, you who knew my mother, my home, the way I was reared, all this knowledge doesn't help you to know that I am not a murderer."
"All that knowledge goes for nothing against the life you led afterward, the life of deliberate sin. You lived with that woman, and did not marry her, and left her to starve."
"No, no. I gave her more money than I carried away myself when I went to Africa. I wrote to her directly I had money to send her. She had shifted her lodgings, poor soul, and never received my remittance. But the first money I earned over and above the day's bread and the night's shelter were sent to her."
"Oh, it was base and cruel of you to leave her, base and cruel not to marry her, not to redeem the past, not to atone for the evil you had done, for your sinful life."
"Don't prate about my life," he cried fiercely. "What do you know of a young man's life, flung on the world as I was, without a friend, face to face with famine and suicide? When that dead woman was my friend, I had no other. Spare me your schoolgirl sermon, Mary Freeland, and tell me in plain words, do you believe me a murderer?"
Tears were her only answer. She flung herself into a chair, clasped her hands before her face, and sobbed broken-heartedly.
"I have your answer," he said. "I knew you were ignorant of life and the world you live in. but I thought your womanly instinct would have taught you to read the heart and mind of a man who loved you. Goodbye, little Mary. The woman who can believe me a scoundrel must be a stranger to me. You and I have done with each other." He went out of the room and out of the house. She looked up in the midst of her tears and listened, and when she heard the hall door shut behind him, she slipped from the low chair to the floor and lay there sobbing and moaning in self-abasement. Mrs. Tresillian Smith was making a round of visits in the professional brougham, so Miss Freeland had no fear of interruption. The brazen filigree plate without was exhibited on the hall table, and the drawing-room offered the isolation of a tomb. Poor Mary! Everybody about her had talked of Wildover's guilt, as if it were a fact, mathematically demonstrated. She had heard the case discussed again and again. She had sat pale and sick with mental pain, while indifferent people went over the evidence and allowed no loophole for the possibility of innocence. And then there had been other tortures. It had agonized her to think of his relations with that other woman. She had acted in La Dame aux Camélias, and had the exalted idea which most innocent women cherish about their fallen sisters. She idealized the guilty love, and told herself that such passions always lasted a lifetime. No man was ever cured of a love like that. And while she had flattered herself that he loved her, Mary Freeland, poor commonplace Mary Freeland, he was bound earth and mind by that chain in the romantic past. Yet, if he still loved that other woman, why murder her? Jealousy, perhaps? He might have discovered that she had been false to him in his absence, and this had been his deadly revenge. Most of Mary's views of life were taken from plays or novels, and revenge was a grand factor in the scheme of existence which she had woven out of drama and romance. Oh, she feared that people must have judged him rightly, and that he had done this dreadful thing. How she blessed and thanked Mr. Chilbrick for his successful defense, and the good magistrate who had dismissed the case against Arnold Wildover. He was free. He had all his life before him in which to repent. She thought that he would turn Roman Catholic and join some severe order of monks. She pictured his future in some Trappist monastery, never speaking save to remind a silent brother of man's inevitable doom. Oh, what a sorry end for Arnold, her brave, noble Arnold, the young man whom she had looked up to and admired when she wore a pinafore. She had carried his image in her heart ever since those childish days, and the meeting with him on board the steamer had been like the sudden opening of paradise. Everybody told her that he was guilty. She had sat in her pale silence with sinking heart, nobody heeding her, while a famous Queen's Counsel expatiated upon the Dynevor Street murder and shook his head and shrugged his shoulders. Mary Freeland was young enough to believe in the ineffable wisdom of men of 50, and that a distinguished barrister could not take a wrong view of circumstantial evidence. She had read every word that had been reported of the case, and it seemed to her, in spite of that missing link in the matter of the weapon, that no one could doubt Arnold's guilt. She did not think of him as a cold-blooded murderer. She tried to mitigate the blackness of that dreadful crime. He had not meant to kill the woman he had loved. Jealousy, revenge, some great convulsion of tragic passion had maddened him. He had been moved by blind fury, had been for a moment a madman. She made her own theory of the murder, even while she bowed to the superior, middle-aged wisdom which denied the possibility of his innocence. If she admitted his guilt, she would at least have him guilty in her own way. The post upon the evening following Arnold's visit brought Mary Freeland a letter from him. She had not left her room since their meeting, the mere idea of Mrs. Tresillian Smith's social circle being intolerable. She had pleaded a headache of the most distressing character, and her pallid face and heavy eyelids sustained the plea,
together with the fact that she had been looking wretchedly ill ever since she came to Hexton Gardens. "I really am afraid South Kensington doesn't agree with her," Mrs. Smith said solemnly, as if such a fact hardly came within the range of the possible. "She wants a tonic," Dr. Smith answered carelessly. "I'll have a look at her before lunch." Mary Freeland allowed her host to prescribe for her, and lay all day in her darkened room persistently miserable. It was the last post which brought her Arnold's letter a little before 10 o'clock. She heard the squeaking of a violin as the housemaid opened the door, and she had been hearing carriages stopping and bells ringing and doors opening and shutting for the last half hour, inasmuch as this was one of Mrs. Tressilian Smith's evenings. She sprang up from her bed directly the housemaid left her and ran to her writing-table, where there was a candle burning under a rose-colored shade. Half the elegance of Mrs. Tressilian Smith's house was expressed in paper candle-shades. She tore off the envelope with trembling fingers, and her eyes devoured Arnold's letter, which began without any formula of courtesy or affection. "When I walked into the street yesterday afternoon a free man, acquitted by the magistrate's dismissal, it never entered my thoughts that any mortal could believe me guilty. How much less, then, could I think that you, Mary, would be my accuser? You, who know my father and mother, who know from what race I spring, of what stuff I am made, you to believe me a murderer? It is unthinkable. My mind cannot realize the condition of yours. Since I saw you yesterday, I have seen the same belief in other faces. I have begun to feel myself a pariah. My first intention, after leaving you, was to go straight back to Africa. I even went to the shipping agent and was on the point of engaging my berth on the next outgoing steamer, when I changed my plan in a moment. It would be a craven's part to beat a retreat before an unjust judgment, even though inclination would take me back to the gold fields and the hard free life that suited me so well. No, I said to myself, I will hold my ground. I will not leave England till I have cleared myself in Mary's eyes. That was my resolve yesterday evening, Mary. That is my determination today. Henceforth, I shall only live to clear myself of this odious suspicion. The sole business of my life would be to prove to you, if not to the rest of the world, that this hand of mine is not the hand of a murderer. And that I should murder her, that gentle, unoffending creature, ever ready to expiate her sorrowful past by acts of womanly self-sacrifice? All my business with her that night was to persuade her to one last act of self-abnegation. I was bound to her by every tie of honor and affection, and I asked her to release me from that sacred obligation in order that I might offer myself to another woman whose youth and innocence had stolen into my heart unawares. And now, youth and innocence, for which I was ready to break a loving woman's heart, condemn me unheard. It is the irony of fate, Mary. Her love, guilty as you would deem it, was the rock. Yours is the sifting sand. But I mean to prove that I am not the villain you think me. A. W. That was all. There were no tender words, though the letter told her for the first time that he had loved her. Had loved her. His love was dead now, she thought. It had withered at her cruel accusation. She to believe him guilty, she who had known him in his boyhood, she who had spent those happy days with him on board the ship. Could she associate the idea of a horrid crime with the man she had loved and admired and believed in only a few weeks ago? She hated herself for her conduct of yesterday. There had been time for her to repent of her weak-mindedness, her folly in believing that hateful Queen's Counsel, and all those wretches who were eager to condemn a man of whom they knew nothing. Of whom they knew nothing, yes, that was their excuse for harsh judgment. But that she, his playfellow of old, his friend of a few weeks past, she who knew every line in his face every tone in his voice, that she could think him a murderer. Well, it only served to prove what a brainless creature she was. A woman with brains would never have misjudged him, she told herself. All her ideas about him had altered since yesterday. She needed only to see him and hear him for her feelings and convictions to change. Not at first, not in a moment, but in those long hours in which she had lain in her darkened room with aching heart and aching head, that no tonic treatment could cure, recalling his looks and words, living over again that terrible interview which she had meant to be their last. She had condemned him upon circumstantial evidence, like those foolish drawing-room babblers who had prated about the network of circumstance which enmeshed him. She had recalled the change in his mood a few days before the vessel came into port, his gloomy manner, his curious avoidance of her, his troubled air the morning they parted, the morning of Christmas Eve. She remembered his agitation upon reading the report of the murder, how he had stood before her ghastly and speechless. On such evidence as this, strengthened by the details in the newspapers and the almost universal opinion of his guilt, Mary Freeland had condemned him. She hated herself now for her willingness to think evil. A woman whose love was worth having would have trusted him in spite of the world, she thought. How he must despise me! What a poor creature he must think me! She read his contempt for her between the lines of his letter, his allusions to that dead woman, the woman he had loved for years and who had been to him as a wife, stung Mary Freeland to the quick. She was jealous of his regard for that poor ghost. She would have acted like a heroine, thought Mary, and I have acted like a fool. He can never care for me again. He may want to clear himself from that hideous charge, to make me repent my words, but not for love of me, only from a man's natural pride in his own character. He wants to clear himself for his own sake, not for mine. There was no address upon Arnold's letter, or Mary would have written to him that night in her subjugation of spirit. She would have written upon her knees to implore his pardon. She could know no happiness in life till she had made atonement to him. The next morning she was really ill, and Dr. Tressilian Smith brought in a brother practitioner later in the day for a consultation. As an inmate of his house in his wife's charge, almost a ward, he was particularly anxious about her. "She has looked languid and miserable ever since she has been with us," he told the physician, "though she would never have confessed to feeling ill. Nothing my wife could do to put her in good spirits was of any use. We were told she was a high-spirited, lively girl, but I really don't believe such a doleful young woman ever came into a house." "A love affair, no doubt," said the doctor, and having determined that the mind was out of gear, he straightway prescribed for the cure of the body, which, after all, seemed to be the more important element in the matter. "The poor child has fretted herself into a low fever," he said. "I should send her to the East Coast, if I were you, Smith, as soon as you get her up again, and let her ride or play golf for a month or two." End of Chapter 8.
Chapter 9 of Rough Justice. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Lena Emsley. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 9. Mr. Faunce's Record. My good little wife had for a long time been urging me to wind up my association with Bow Street and retire into private life and a cottage villa with a garden at Putney, which neighbourhood she considered a kind of paradise as compared with Bloomsbury. I own to being fond of Bloomsbury and to having a liking for a profession which some people might consider disagreeable. But when Providence has bestowed a good wife upon a man, it is his business to prove himself worthy of the gift. So I had made up my mind to retire for some time past, and I think the Dynevor Street business turned the scale and precipitated my withdrawal from the Criminal Investigation Department. I was sorry to part company with the men I knew, and with whom I had worked in friendly association, but I felt I had had enough of work which took a great deal out of me, and brought me a very moderate recompense. So one fine morning, not long after the breakdown of the case against Wildover, I went through the process of securing my pension, and took a lease of Hawthorne Lodge, Putney Hill. It was a new sensation to be sauntering about Wimbledon Common in the early mornings, a new thing to hear the skylark in the blue above, and the cattle lowing in the meadows. I used to walk for miles and miles through the lanes towards Ewell and Epsom, for I had never been too good a sleeper, and now that I had nothing to do and very little to think about, I found myself walking with the sun, and it was a relief to get out into the air and see him make his ascent. I had seen the sun rise often enough in the course of my wanderings, but I had usually seen him at the end of the night, after spending the small hours in London streets, or on the railway, or down the river. It was a new thing to see him at the beginning of my day, fresh from my bed and bath, and it was a still newer thing to be free from restraint, and to be released from responsibility, no longer to feel that every step in life was a step in the dark, that guilt and innocence, honour and dishonour, life and liberty, were the counters in the game which I was winning or losing, no longer to be incessantly on the alert, to check erring comrades, to restrain excess of zeal, and to teach the value of truth to men who were inclined to think they could get along better without it. My good wife accused me of being restless, and not appreciating the comforts of a retired life, or being sufficiently grateful to Providence for having given me enough to live upon and pay £45 a year for Hawthorne Lodge. My dear Charlotte Eliza, I dare say I shall get habituated to a life of idleness in time, said I. But when a man has been working for 30 years, idleness is apt to pall. I confess that I sometimes feel a something wanting, and I'm afraid it's Bow Street. This inconsiderate admission of mine made the poor little wife cry, and she began to reproach herself for having withdrawn me from a profession I liked. So I had to assure her I was very happy at Putney, and to take her for a long walk on the common, where we saw two old gentlemen playing golf. "There's the garden," said Charlotte Eliza. "I look forward to your being interested in the garden." "And so I am, my dear," says I. "But as it only takes me about 20 steps to walk round our lawn and flower beds, that kind of interest is soon exhausted." "I thought you would work in the garden, John. People who work in their gardens never seem to have finished or to be tired." "Any work I did in the way of gardening would be so destructive that you would implore me to desist before I had been at it 2 days, Charlotte Eliza," said I. And she sighed and said no more about the garden. In sober truth, a life of retirement did not suit me. I am not what is called a domestic man. I don't bully the cook or discover cobwebs in the cornice. I have no home occupations, except reading newspapers and novels. And though I had enjoyed both forms of literature while I was a busy man, fact and fiction lost their zest now that I was an idler. In this frame of mind, I was startled by a visitor, whose appearance was as refreshing as a cold douche after a Turkish bath. I was sitting alone in a little closet of a room at the back of the house, which my wife calls the study, but which I never look at without regretting the spaciousness of our old quarters at Bloomsbury. It was after our early dinner, and I was smoking a pipe of meditation, having exhausted every scrap of news in four morning papers, down to the markets, although the prices of tallow, and even of mutton and beef by the carcass, could have but the mildest interest for a man whose household consisted of four people, and whose consumption of tallow and butcher's meat was very moderate. I had heard the doorbell, and the opening of the door, but as my wife has a good many visitors and I have very few, I had scarcely noticed the fact, when the housemaid — she took the superior rank of parlour-maid in the afternoon — opened the door of my den with the grandest air, and announced Mr. Wildover. There was no card sent in, no preliminary inquiry. The gentleman whom I had last seen in the dock at Bow Street walked calmly into my room, and the room being only 13 feet by 11, was standing in front of me before I had time to think. I laid down my pipe and stood up, and I was face to face with a man round whose neck I had tried my best to put a rope. "I dare say you're surprised to see me here, Mr. Faunce," he said coolly. "I am really more surprised than I can say, sir," said I. "You would have seen me sooner but for two circumstances. In the first place, I have been ill, and in the second place, when I was well enough to get about, I found it extremely difficult to find you. The people at Bow Street seemed very unwilling to give me your address." "Oh, you have been hovering about Bow Street, have you? That seems a curious proceeding for a man in your circumstances. I thought a nice little trip to the Antipodes, or a tour in South America, would have been more in your line." I had not asked him to sit down, and I was still standing. I had had a good deal of intercourse with murderers during my official career, but now I had retired into private life, I meant to have as few dealings as possible with the criminal breed. And yet I could but own to myself that this man was a remarkable specimen of that class of villain whom nobody would take for a villain. From head to foot I could see upon him no mark of the criminal character. His erect form and easy bearing, the straight and steady look of his well-opened blue eyes, the firm yet kindly mouth, the broad forehead and finely modelled chin, would have made a favourable impression anywhere, and upon anybody. If ever there was a criminal who perversely degraded a form and face meant for righteousness, it was this man. Always supposing him to be the murderer I thought him, in spite of that incident of the pistol. "As I have a good deal to say to you, I hope you will be good enough to sit down and hear me patiently," he said, seating himself in the chair opposite my own, which brought his feet and mine within 18 inches of each other. "And if, as you were smoking when I came in, you will kindly allow me to light my pipe, we shall feel quite comfortable." "I don't know your motive for seeking me out, Mr. Wildover," said I, "but I am bound to tell you that I have left the Criminal Investigation Department, and that I take no further interest in crime or criminals." "Perhaps not," said he, "but I hope you are interested in a man who has suffered cruelly through your mistake. Come, Faunce, you worked very hard the other day to make me out a murderer, and you succeeded in putting a black mark against my name that has blighted all my hopes of happiness in this life. I want you to work still harder to take that stain off my name and character. It is to be done, and you are the man to do it." His easy manners and confident tone took me altogether aback. I had never had to do with such a man. I had seen an innocent man in an hole often enough before today. But your innocent man is generally a poor creature, ready to shed tears and all of a tremble, half out of his wits at the very idea of being suspected. This man was as firm as the base rock. He ordered me to write his character. I reminded him that I had left the force. "So much the better for me," he said. "You couldn't have worked my business as I want it worked if you were still under the police authorities." And then he told me that without being a rich man, he had made a good bit of money in the South African gold fields, and still owned a share in a mine at the river diggings, where he could make more money if he cared to go back. But he had made up his mind not to leave England till he had solved the mystery of Lisa Rayner's death. It may have been the most common kind of crime, though it is a mystery to us till we find the murderer. It may have been the work of some loafing scoundrel who saw me give that poor soul the notes, and lurked about and watched us, and contrived to slip into the house behind our backs while we stood talking, believing that he would have time to take the money from her before anybody was roused by the shot. He must have been a consummate fool to have thought that possible, said I. A pistol fired in an inhabited house at 1 o'clock in the morning, the fall of a body, enough to rouse any household from attic to cellar. Well, the hope of plunder seems to be the only reasonable explanation. I took a notebook from a desk which was close at my elbow, and referred to Wildover's account of that last conversation in Dynevor Street. I saw that in this statement he had said he had given Lisa Rayner the notes during their last turn in the street, and only a few minutes before he bade her good-bye at the door of number 13. It was, of course, quite within the range of possibility that some loafer should have seen her take this money, but for that loafer to be provided with a revolver, and to be audacious enough to follow her up to her room and shoot her in an house full of people, hoping to pocket the notes and get clear off after his victim had fallen dead on the garret floor, seemed hardly credible. In my idea of the crime, the murderer must have intended murder only, and must have trusted to rapidity of action for escape. To return to my original notion, here was a life to be suppressed, and all the murderer wanted was to suppress it. The man fascinated me and won my confidence. There was something uncommonly winning in that handsome face, the frank manner, and the free and easy give-and-take style of a man who had lived and worked under God's open sky, caring nothing for the things which men in cities so much overestimate: dress, dinner, furniture, society, all the tailor-made stuff that Thomas Carlyle ridicules. Here was a man not dependent upon his tailor for style or dignity. His rough tweed trousers were kneed and turned up at the ankles. His boots were broad and clumsy. His frieze overcoat had the marks of long wear. And yet I knew he was a gentleman. "Well, Mr. Wildover," said I, after turning the business over in my mind, "I thought I had done with criminal investigation forever. But I don't mind owning this case interests me, because it is a difficult one, and I don't mind seeing what can be done about it. Not much, perhaps." "Yes, much. Everything, by a man of your experience. The man who dropped the pistol down the area was the man who murdered Lisa Rayner. You have the gunsmith who can tell you what that man was like." "The man who dropped the pistol may not be the man who bought the pistol. It may have changed hands, you know, Mr. Wildover." I watched his face closely as I spoke. Much as I was taken by his good looks and pleasant manner, I was by no means convinced of his innocence. I had seen too much of pleasant-mannered murderers in my time, more particularly in the poisoning branch. There never was a better sort than Bill Palmer till he was found out. It was in Wildover's favour that his was not an arsenic case. "Yes," said he, "true enough. The pistol may have changed hands. Anyhow, you have to find the man who dropped it down the area." "I'll do my best, sir. But before I begin, I am bound to remind you that you have not been tried and acquitted, and that you might be arrested again tomorrow if any further and stronger evidence came up against you. It might therefore be more to your interest, safer, for you to drop out of this part of the world and let sleeping dogs lie." "I am not afraid of any dogs that you or anybody else can rouse, Mr. Faunce. Don't concern yourself about my safety, but try to clear my name of the foul stain your official skill has put upon it. I told him my idea of the murder was the putting away of an individual whose existence was a source of trouble and danger to somebody else, and I asked him to tell me all he knew of Mrs. Rayner's history, omitting no detail that he could remember. He replied with apparent candour, and told me the story of her life before he met her, as she had told it to him, and during the years they had spent in poverty together. There was nothing in this story to suggest a vendetta, no hint of dark secrets or blackmailing. The Austrian seducer had disappeared from the scene. The father seemed to have made no effort to reclaim his lost daughter, yet the middle-aged seducer and the unprincipled father were the only discoverable personages linked with the woman's story, if she had told Wildover the whole of that story. But there is the likelihood that a woman who has gone wrong, like a man who has got into debt, will always keep back something, and that, perhaps the biggest item in the history, or in the list of creditors. I was inclined to believe that in this case, all had not been disclosed, and that in the something that had been kept back lay the clue to the mystery. She had told him the story of her girlhood, in outline only. He did not know her father's name, or the name of the Viennese banker under whose protection she had lived at the West End of London. He did not know of any human being whose acquaintance she had made during her season of prosperity, or the address of the house in which he had lived. He had forbidden her to dwell upon that unhappy past. It hurt him too much to hear her talk of her fall. "You see, I loved her at that time as dearly as if she had been my wedded wife, and her dishonour was my dishonour. She had been a devoted helpmeet to me. I wanted to respect her. I hate, now that she is in her grave, to repeat the confession which she made to me when she was recovering from a dangerous illness." "No doubt. But if you didn't tell me all you can, I shouldn't have the slightest chance of unravelling the mystery," I said. "As it is, I must tell you plainly that I consider the odds against me about 100 to 1. But I am a man of leisure now, and by way of filling in some of the spare hours of my life — I didn't tell him that I had about 10 hours to spare per diem — I don't mind trying what my long and varied experience with the CI department may enable me to do." He thanked me, begged me to consider money no object, wanted to give me his cheque for £100 there and then, but I told him that in the present state of things I didn't see my way to spending 5 shillings on his account, and so we parted, after I had asked him to call upon me that day fortnight at the same hour. He begged me to make it that day week, but I told him that it was very unlikely I should have anything to tell him after a fortnight's looking about. I began work with very little hope of success, but I was glad to have something to do and to think about outside my garden at Hawthorne Lodge. I was heartily tired of watching the tulips slowly, and it seemed to me reluctantly, coming out of their green sheaths, and of wondering whether the standard rose trees, which had been pruned almost out of existence, would really justify the skilled gardener and break out into branch and bloom before midsummer. Frankly, I was delighted to see Dynevor Street again. I told my wife that I had undertaken a private matter, which, if successful, would pay me handsomely, and I believe Charlotte Eliza was not sorry to see me occupied with business which took me out of doors, and left her free to dust the china ornaments and polish the furniture without being worried by an husband who didn't know what to do with himself. I saw the gunsmith's assistant, and tried to get a better description of the man who had bought the pistol, but I could extract nothing beyond the impression that he was a studious-looking man, wearing blue spectacles, and his hair longer than the fashion, and that he was several inches shorter than Wildover. The difference in height would alone have been enough to show that the man was not Wildover. But the two men were in all respects unlike each other. "Should you know the man if you saw him again?" I asked. "No, I remember the kind of man, but there was nothing remarkable about him, nothing that would help me pick him out among a dozen men of the same style. I've seen them coming out of the British Museum of an evening by the score, when I lived in the Hampstead Road and used to walk home by Great Russell Street." "Do you think the spectacles he wore were intended as a disguise?" "Oh, dear, no. His manner was too easy and collected for such an idea to occur to me. Not much to be made of the gunmaker's assistant. There was only that suggestion of the purchaser's scholarly appearance, the type of man to be seen leaving the reading room of the British Museum any evening. I had met them often enough during my long residence in Bloomsbury, and I knew the style. It is hardly possible for the uninitiated in criminal investigation to conceive the difficulty of finding any person or anything in the great ocean of London life when once the bubble on the surface of the water was broken and vanished. I had started on a wrong scent, if Wildover was to be believed, and I had wasted my time in following a phantom, when there might have been the possible opportunities of getting on the right line. I had to begin again, with the scent cold, and I own that I felt nonplussed, and that I only set to work in a dilettante spirit, and with less mental energy than I should have expended upon an acrostic in the world. It was something to do. It kept my mind busy, just as the game of cat's cradle will keep children's hands busy, and it was, I feared, about as futile an occupation. It is needless to record my investigation step by step. It was several weeks after Wildover's first visit to Hawthorne Lodge when I made my first advance along the line on which I had been working. By the discovery that a person answering to the gunmaker's description had been living in Dynevor Street at the date of the murder, and had left so shortly after as to make his removal a suspicious coincidence. I had made an house-to-house investigation of the street, and had in most instances been readily answered. But there was one house where the people seemed very reluctant to give any information about the persons lodging there in the previous December. The landlord owned at last that he had a reason for this reticence. "If your business has anything to do with dynamite or Nihilists, I'm not going to be mixed up in it," he said. "Poor Mrs. Grogan's been all but ruined by that murder last Christmas. She's not been able to let her second floor since, or the room where the young woman was murdered,
and I know she's half a year behind with her rent, and I don't want my house to be pointed at and boycotted because of some gentleman dynamite as may have lodged in it once upon a time." I assured him that the inquiries I was making had no relation to dynamiters or nihilists, and I also gave him to understand that it would be the worse for him if he refused to answer my questions to the very best of his ability. I may add that this was a bit of a bluff on my part, as I was assuming my authority of former times, before I retired from the CI department. The effect was instantaneous, for Mr. Durfin's wife, a decent body, who was present at our interview, urged him to comply with my request. The house was a lodging-house, tidily furnished, and as clean as a London house can be. And it is wonderful what miracles of freshness and cleanliness an hard-working, active woman can achieve, in spite of sea coal and November fogs. Without being directly opposite number 13, the windows commanded a full view of that house, and a watcher at the window on this side of the way would have been able to identify anyone going out or in at Mrs. Grogan's door. Now for my landlord and landlady's information. Once having relented, they were both eager to tell me all that they could. They had had a gentleman lodger on their second floor from the 14th of November to the 26th of December, and just such a gentleman as the subject of my inquiry. Very studious, very quiet and retiring, spending the greater part of his days out of doors. Mostly, they believed, in the reading room at the British Museum, as he had told them he chose these rooms in order to be near the museum, and sitting up late at night, reading and writing. He had taken no meal at home, except his roll and coffee in the morning. He had had his own machine for making tea, a Sadover, Mrs. Durfin called it, a Russian machine. "Named after the great Russian battle," interjected the landlord. "There never was a less troublesome lodger. He had his latch key and let himself in of a night as quiet as a ghost. He paid his rent and all extras to the moment. He gave his name as Longman, no Christian name. He received no letters and had no visitors. A most retired gentleman." "Did this lodger wear spectacles?" "Yes, always. He was a great sufferer with his eyes, had burnt off his eyelashes while making a chemical experiment, he told Mrs. Durfin, which admission, with other things, the Russian Sadover, for instance, had made them suspect him of being a dynamiter. He had just the quiet way of a conspirator biding his time, yet quite the gentleman through it all, and must have been at the top of the tree, and one as gave his orders for others to carry out. They had looked at his luggage, and they were sure there wasn't an ounce of dynamite in that. A spare suit of clothes and half a dozen shirts was all he brought to the house, and those things were all arranged in the chest of drawers, and everything the pink of neatness. He brought a few books, a writing case, and a packet of foolscap. He was a great one for scribbling. Had he left any papers, anything overlooked about his rooms? Nothing, except the torn papers in the waste basket. Those had been used for lighting fires directly after he left. Did he give you any reference when he came? He gave us a week's rent, and that, with his respectable appearance, was quite satisfactory. Asked his age, Mr. Durfin guessed it at 30. Mrs. Durfin gave him 5 or 6 years more. He was not bald, but his hair was very thin at the top of his head, straight, dark brown hair, worn rather long. Asked to describe him as precisely as they could, Mr. and Mrs. Durfin furnished me with these details. Height, say 5 feet 9 or 10. hands and feet small and particularly well-shaped. His boots was a pleasure to black, Mr. Durfin added. Any maker's name in the boots? No. Nose aquiline, small nostrils, chin very square and firm. A chin you would never try to impose upon, even if you was given to imposing, which we Durfins are not. Complexion pale, nondescript, neither fair nor dark, what Mr. Durfin would call the London complexion. Any scar, peculiarity of expression, or distinguishing mark about the man? None. Did they remember the manner of his leaving their house on the 26th of December? Yes, so far as there was anything to remember. He went out early on Christmas Day, and was absent all day, returning in an hansom before midnight. Mr. Durfin noticed that he was in evening dress when he came home, though he had left the house in his usual dark grey suit. He went away with his portmanteau in a four-wheeler early on Boxing Day. Mr. Durfin heard him tell the cabman, Waterloo, Loop Line, and concluded that he was going out of town from that station. He had told them nothing of his plans, only asking for his account half an hour before he left. He paid a week's rent in lieu of notice. The second floor had been let to a married couple and baby from Manchester since Mr. Longman left, but these had gone back to the north a fortnight previously, so the rooms were empty and I was welcome to look at them. I was sorry to find the rooms had been let, for this fact, taken in conjunction with Mrs. Durfin's cleanly habits, made it very unlikely that so much as a stray inch of paper left by Mr. Longman remained upon the premises. My experience has shown me that people of the criminal class, however careful to remove all compromising material, will almost inevitably leave something in any house they have occupied. But in rooms turned out and cleaned, and occupied and turned out and cleaned again after that occupation, I could scarcely hope to find any trace of a departed lodger. I went up to the second floor, however, and used my eyes and my fingers to their utmost power. My eyes were quick enough to notice an old-fashioned bureau chest of drawers with a sloping lid, which I lifted, displaying that arrangement of small drawers and pigeonholes which our ancestors loved. "Did your last lodgers make use of this nice old piece of furniture?" I asked. "Not they, sir," replied Mrs. Durfin, who had accompanied me, being better at stairs than her husband. "I don't believe they wrote half a dozen letters while they were with us. They were always gadding. They came up to see the sights of London, and it was theatres and music halls night after night, and supper wanted afterwards. And it was Crystal Palace and Two Swords or Tower every day. Mr. Longman, he wrote at the desk all the time he was here, and a fine state the mahogany was in with ink when he left it." "And you cleaned it carefully, I have no doubt." "I did all that beeswax and turpentine and elbow grease could do," she said, and I hated the woman for her uncompromising cleanliness. "And you found no papers in any of these drawers?" I asked, pulling them all out one after another as I talked, and peering into the recesses and secret places of the bureau. Mrs. Durfin coughed and paused before replying. One look at her told me that she had found something, but I went on with my examination of the drawers and pigeonholes, pretending to be interested in the bureau as a piece of furniture. Mrs. Durfin coughed again. "Me and Durfin don't want to be mixed up in non-Irish cases," she said. "It's difficult enough to make a living in a street that keeps steadfastly going down without that." I assured her that I was no nihilist hunter. I had certainly a motive in seeking information about Mr. Longman, but it had to do with property, not nihilism. The good woman's brow lightened at this, and she told me that if she had known I was a respectable family solicitor, she would have been more free with me, and on that she produced a very ancient purse from her capacious pocket, and from this purse extracted a small leaf of paper, evidently torn from a notebook, which leaflet she solemnly handed to me. "That was the only scrap of paper that I found high or low after Mr. Longman left," she said, "and my husband thinks the writing on it is a nihilist cipher. Neither me nor him can make out a letter of it." The cipher was the common, or Pitman, shorthand, and I assured Mrs. Durfin that there was nothing of a treasonable or alarming character in the document, which I should be glad to keep if she would allow me. I slipped a sovereign into her willing hand as I made the request. "I think you might make it 2 sovereigns, sir, seeing that it's the only paper as he left, and may lead to valuable information."
"Oh, Mrs. Durfin, what a woman of business you are," said I, as I gave her the 2nd sovereign and went off with my find. It wasn't much, but it was something. I carried it straight to a typewriting office, where there are a lot of clever girls working under a very clever young lady, some of them well up in shorthand. They know me at the office, and are ready and willing to work for me. "I am coming back for that paper and a typewritten copy of it in 30 minutes, said I. "You'd better wait in my room," said the principal. "I never wait anywhere, my dear young lady. I can do something better with my time than waiting in a room, if it's only watching the faces in the street." The copy and the original document were in an envelope ready for me when I went back to the office. 2 pages of widely spaced typewriting, neither beginning nor end, a fragment of an essay or a lecture, I could not tell which, but the indications pointed to oral delivery. Subject: the everlasting working man, his educational opportunities, and possibilities of improvement. So much for the one trace the lodger had left behind him. And now what did I think of Mr. Longman as a promising subject for further investigation? Not much, assuredly. The facts that he had worn spectacles that hid his eyes, and that his description answered fairly enough to the gunmaker's description of his customer, were something, but still not much. Spectacles are so common, even the blue disguising goggle, and all descriptions of figure and appearance are so vague. The circumstance of Longman's departure on Boxing Day was curious, more especially as that departure was evidently unpremeditated, or the usual notice would have been given. Yet a studious man with his head in the clouds might omit such notice from sheer forgetfulness. The date of his hiring the lodgings coincided very nearly with the date of the purchase of the pistol. That fact was also curious. But I have seen too many curious coincidences to attach much importance to them. Altogether, the indications pointing to Longman as the murderer were of the most shadowy. But so far I had been able to find nothing better, and I was inclined to follow these feeble lights across the quagmire of the unknown. The notes of lecture, essay or book might lead to my identification of the writer, and the man once within my ken, it might be possible to make such retrospective investigation of his life as would reveal a connecting link between him and the murdered woman. My first business, therefore, was to trace the 47 lines of typewriting, and this was by no means an hopeful business, since it was likely enough that these lines formed part of some unpublished essay or unspoken lecture, and belonged to that vast mass of written thought which never finds a public expression. End of chapter 9. Chapter 10 of Rough Justice. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Lena Emsley. Rough Justice by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Chapter 10. Chums. Very bitter was the slow onward progress of the year to Arnold Wentworth, alone in London, that stony wilderness which was to his mind lonelier than the great Karoo, more desolate than the lion-trodden sands of Central Africa. He was idle and aimless, waiting for the solution of the mystery that had overshadowed his life and darkened his dream of the future. Oh, that look of Mary's, that altered face, that agony of unbelief in him! He had left her full of scorn and anger, but afterwards, in the long hours of brooding upon the same miserable theme, he had owned to himself that she was scarcely to be blamed for her want of faith. The web of circumstances encircled him too closely. He hated London and his purposeless life there, and longed for Johannesburg and the mines, the fever of the auction mart in the miners' city, the rough companionship upon the Rand, the loud talk of mixed nationalities sitting about under the trees, smoking and drinking in the starlit evening, the life that was all labour and hope, and the luxury of rest after labour. And London after this, the burning pavements, the narrow horizons, the dust-laden trees and scorched grass of metropolitan parks, the aching sense of loneliness and desertion, of being a pariah, outside the lives that were going on around him, lives full of action and gladness. He sat in the park for two or three afternoons to enjoy the sunlight and flowers, and he heard people talking at his elbow, a jargon which he understood a little less than the language of Bechuanaland and the Hottentot clique. Something he knew of those African tongues from the talk of native workmen in the compound, but of this modish slang, nothing. He was not rich in the sense that the minor millionaire is rich, but he had made money and invested it in the mine, and he had an income that enabled him to live after his modest fashion, and which would justify marriage with a wife of modest pretensions. He took a fourth-floor flat in a newly built house on the Thames embankment, between Waterloo and Blackfriars Bridges. He liked the river view and the southern exposure. There was more sunshine here, he thought, than anywhere in the smoky wilderness, and he liked the river traffic. He felt utterly stranded and alone in that riverside eyrie, but he had no inclination for society of any kind while the shadow of Mary Freeland's unbelief still rested upon him. One of his first acts after his interview with Mary Freeland had been to sacrifice that fine tawny beard which had given such character to his face. It was with a clean-shaved countenance that he entered upon residence in his new rooms, and the people of the house knew him only under that aspect. Comparing his face in the glass with the rough sketches of the accused that had appeared in the evening papers, he thought that there was little to apprehend from anybody's memory of those rough and ready outline drawings, which, for his good fortune, had not been like enough to be recognised by his family or any of his English friends. Even should the murderer himself have kept those illustrated pages,
he would scarcely identify the smooth-shaven face of the living man with those sketchy suggestions of a face in which the beard had been much exaggerated. The change in his complexion, as the South African bronze gradually faded and left his skin of its original Anglo-Saxon fairness, was almost as marked as the change effected by the razor. So far, his visits to the little villa at Putney had resulted only in disappointment. Faunce had nothing to tell him, and was altogether discouraging. "I think you must consider the story closed with your dismissal," he said. "The time that was lost while we were following up a false scent is time that can never be recovered. Suppose I were to hear of a man who, from circumstances of time and place, might be the man we want. How am I to connect that man with the murder? The threads are all dropped, all broken. I'm afraid I'm wasting my time, which is not of much consequence, as I have time enough and to spare, and wearing out your patience, which is worse." "You have found such a man," Arnold exclaimed, all eagerness and fire in a moment. Mr. Faunce described his investigation of the Durfin lodgings, and produced the typewritten copy of the lodger's shorthand notes. "I have given a duplicate copy to a man I know who is shorthand reporter for one of the morning papers, and who might be able to identify the writer of those notes, always supposing that they form part of an essay or a lecture that has been published and reported," said Mr. Faunce. "Yes, yes, it ought to be easy to find the writer from such an indication. Longman was an assumed name, no doubt." "I don't know about that. We have nothing against this man but a coincidence, the mere fact that he left his lodging within 36 hours of the murder. We have no more right to think him a murderer than the Durfins had to think him a nihilist." "Oh, yes, we have. His living in that place, in a secret manner." "Why secret? How secret?" "Why, the fact that no mortal ever visited him there would show that he was hiding." "Not necessarily. He may be a student of solitary habits." "There is no man so solitary as to be without acquaintance, to live in a house for 6 weeks without being visited by anyone." "And then the spectacles, the same kind of spectacles which the gunmaker described. A disguise, evidently a disguise." "All that would go for nothing, Mr. Wildover. If I could put my hand upon this Longman today, I have no evidence against him. And I see no probability of our ever finding any evidence against him, or against anyone else. The murder was a clean piece of work. It was easy enough to connect you with the crime. There were the bank notes. There was the suggestion of motive. Conjectural, of course. But to connect anyone else, hopeless, I fear." Arnold went away, depressed and disheartened. Should he never be able to prove to that cruel girl how shamefully she had misjudged him? It was of Mary he thought, Mary who had become all the world to him during that happy voyage from summer to winter. Ah, how typical in its climatic changes of the hard fate that he was to find on his native soil. He was strolling along the embankment 2 or 3 days after his interview with Faunce, when he came face to face with Wilmot Armstrong, his late partner on the Rand, whom he had last seen at Heidelberg. He would have crossed the road to avoid the man if he could. He did not want to see in another once friendly face the cruel change that had been seen in Mary Freeland. But it was impossible to escape the meeting. They had almost run against each other.
"Why, this is lucky, old chap," exclaimed Armstrong. "I have been wanting to see you ever since I landed, but I didn't know where to look for you in this crowded ant heap." "I wonder you wanted to see me," Arnold answered gloomily. "A man who has been accused of murder is not quite the most eligible acquaintance." "What, Arnold? Did you suppose I should think any the worse of you for your bad luck last Christmas? You couldn't be such a muff as to think I could believe you guilty if the evidence against you had been twice as strong." Something like a sob choked Arnold's first attempt at a reply. He turned away from his friend and stood looking at the river for a minute or so. "When I came out of prison, I found that, though I had been practically acquitted, there were people who still thought me a murderer," he said at last. "It would have been only natural for you to think as badly of me. I suppose you read all about the murder. And I suppose I remembered how you and I had slept under the same roof, and lived and worked side by side for 2 years, and how you nursed me when I was sick, and lectured me when I took too much liquor, and were brother and father to me in one. I suppose that experience would go for something when I saw my old chum brought before the beak on suspicion of a cowardly murder. If it had been a plucky, open-hearted murder, between man and man, a scuffle, an oath, a shot, I might have thought my old chum had gone wrong. But the murder of an inoffensive woman? No, Arnold, I knew that wasn't in your line."
"Thank God," said Arnold, with a deep-drawn breath. "Now I know there is such a thing as friendship in the world."
"Why, you stupid old duffer, what else did you expect?" asked Armstrong indignantly.
"Men are better than women, after all," Arnold said to himself as he walked silently by his friend's side. This was the first of friendly companionship that Arnold had known since he had left the police court. He had talked of Longman's isolation as a suspicious circumstance, but his own solitude in his riverside chambers had been as complete. It was a new sensation to walk the streets in friendly talk with a light-hearted companion. He and Armstrong dined together at the Savoy, and the gaiety and brightness of a popular restaurant afforded a new sensation to the man who had lived alone, brooding over his troubles. "Did they talk of me, of the newspaper reports, at the Rand?" he asked later, when he and Armstrong were sitting in the balcony outside his rooms, smoking in the mild stillness of an evening late in May.
"Why, of course they did, and they said it was a jolly shame. Come, old fellow, don't let us talk any more of that business. What you have to do is to forget that it ever happened."
"I can never do that, not even if I find the man who killed her," answered Arnold. "Think what a memory it is for a man to carry about with him. She was in tears when I left her. I think I must have been hard and cruel, though I tried to be kind, and meant to make her future life as easy as money could make it. I had been too ready to tell her that I'd fallen in love with another woman, and that my happiness depended upon being free from old ties. She seemed heartbroken when we parted. And then, within a few minutes, she was lying in her wretched garret, brutally murdered. Do you suppose I can forget that, Wilmot?"
"You must do your best, old chap. And now, what are you going to do with your life?"
"I don't know."
"Have you made it up with your governor?"
"No."
"And do none of your people know your assumed name of Wildover?"
"Luckily for them, they are spared the knowledge of their disgrace."
"And you are not going back to the Rand?"
"I think not."
"Then, my dear fellow, all you have to do is forget that such a man as Wildover ever lived. Henceforth, you are Arnold Wentworth."
"That's easily said. I am known in this house as Wentworth. You can't suppose I would stick to the name of Wildover after it had been dragged through the police court and the newspapers. And now that's enough of me and my gloomy story. Tell me about yourself and your luck since we parted."
This inquiry started Arnold's old friend upon talk that lasted till midnight,
he had done well, wonderfully well, had sold his holding in the mine at a large profit, and had come home, hoping to marry a certain distant cousin who had promised to wait for him when he was down upon his luck. The assurance of Armstrong's friendship gave Arnold new life and hope. Ever since his interview with Mary Freeland in the sunless South Kensington drawing-room, he had thought of himself as a creature under a ban, as low in the social scale as a pariah dog, and he had concentrated all his energies upon the task he had set for himself, and which might be indeed an impossible task, hopeless as the rolling of heavy stones up a hill whose summit he was never to reach. But after his meeting with his old companion, he began to think better of life, to bear his troubles with a new patience, and even to recover something of that fine, frank outlook which had been clouded over by too much gloomy thought. One effect of this change was a growing desire to see Mary Freeland again, and moved by this desire, he consumed a good many of his idle hours roaming the streets and squares of South Kensington, or hanging about the entrance to the art school, in the hope of meeting the girl he loved. He saw her several times, but she was walking with a fellow pupil, and he watched her unobserved from the opposite side of the road, and noted that she was not looking her best, and not looking happy. His keen eye could perceive the change even at that distance. The cheeks that had been so plump and peach-like on the homeward voyage were now pinched and hollow. The eyes had lost their joyous light, and the step, once so quick and free, was slow and languid. Had the air of South Kensington wrought this change, or did remorse for her unkindness to him count for something? At last he took heart of grace, and having seen her part from her girlfriend, crossed the road and threw himself in her way. She was walking home alone, having succeeded in convincing Mrs. Tressilian Smith that the modern girl did not require to be protected by an upper housemaid in so eminently respectable a neighbourhood as the Cromwell Road. The worst that could happen would be for one of those gentlemen tea-touts to introduce himself to me and beg me to give him an order for some new company's tea, said Mary. And as for Rebecca, she is far more attractive than I am. Mrs. Smith was fain to admit that the housemaid, in her outdoor apparel, was a more conspicuous figure than the student. So Mary, dressed very quietly in her black frock and straw hat, was allowed to go to and fro unchaperoned. And thus Arnold was able to waylay her, and walk by her side along the sun-baked spaciousness of South Kensington. He thought she would try to avoid him, but to his infinite relief she held out her hand and smiled at him with the friendly look of happier days. "I'm so very glad to see you," she said, in a voice that trembled a little. "Really? I hardly hoped that." "Oh, I know. I know how shamefully I behaved. I deserved all you said of me in your cruel letter. But, oh, Mr. Wentworth, I think I must have been out of my mind. People had talked and talked till I let myself be persuaded against my own will. And I remembered your agitation at the Briery, and I forgot that having known the unhappy creature—here she grew crimson, and then pale again, and nearly broke down—it was natural you should be distressed on reading of her dreadful death. I was a blind fool to doubt you, to think for one instant that B's brother, dear Mrs. Wentworth's son, could possibly—" Here the fast-flowing tears stopped all speech. Mary felt that she was crying in the face of South Kensington, and that if, by evil chance, she was so beheld by any member of Mrs. Smith's visiting circle, she would never more be allowed to walk those streets unaccompanied. So, to Arnold's surprise, she made a rapid rush across the road and ran into the National History Museum, Arnold following her. Here, seated in one of the rooms, she recovered calmness and was able to resume the conversation. "Well, Mary, it is, of course, a great comfort to me to know that you have altered your mind as to the case against me, and that you are at least as indulgent as the magistrate who let me go. But that doesn't alter my determination to find the real murderer, and to convince you that I had no act or part in Lisa Rayner's death. I am much happier for the thought that I may still possess your friendship. And you will forgive me?" pleaded Mary. "Oh, please tell me that I am forgiven. I have been so miserable ever since I received your letter. When I had read that letter, I saw how blind I had been. It seemed as if a thick black curtain was plucked aside, and I saw you in the clear light of truth. And I hated myself for having let other people put ideas into my head. I have not known a peaceful hour since, and I have just drudged at my horrid antique studies, drudged day after day in the hope of forgetting. Well, Mary, there is nothing to forget now, so I hope you'll be happy again, and find a pleasanter occupation than soiling your pretty fingers with black lead. Will you come home with me and be introduced to Mrs. Tressilian Smith? She really is very kind and good, and I've been such a wet blanket. She thought I was fretting for my aunt's death, and I didn't like to undeceive her. Will you come?" "As far as your door, Mary, but no further. I am not in the mood for making new friends." "Then that means that, although you pretend to have forgiven me, I am not to see you again?" "Not till I have cleared my character effectually, Mary, which can only be done when the real criminal is found." "He will never be found. How can you be so mad as to think it? He has left no trace. A lunatic, perhaps, or a burglar steeped in crime. Who knows? He will never be traced. And is all your life to be sacrificed? Arnold, you do not believe that there is one lingering shadow of doubt in my mind?" "I am glad to believe there is not, my dear, but I have my own self-respect to consider. I must be a free man, bound to no one, cherished by no one, till that stain is lifted from my character." "And how about your poor mother? Is her son to be living so near her? And is she to be made none the happier by his company? I know how dearly she loves you."
"And you know how dearly my father does not love me. Langton Park is no home for me, Mary. Before this trouble came upon me, I had the dream of another home, a home of my own making. But that is all over now, and if I ever succeed in righting myself, it may be too late for that old dream to be realized." Mary made no reply. Words were so near tears with her today, and she did not want to cry any more, or to appear before the Smiths with red eyes.
"We had better say good-bye at the corner of the gardens," she said, after a silence of some minutes, "if you are not going to be introduced." And so, at the corner of that sunless street which called itself Hexton Gardens, they clasped hands and said good-bye. Arnold stood and watched Mary Freeland vanish into the afternoon shadow along the dim perspective of Corinthian porches and projecting windows. End of chapter 10.